W2 W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
85% of the world's working. The other 15 come out here.
If you want to crown them, then crown their ass. But they are who we thought they were. And we let them off the hook.
I'm a man. I'm 40. I'm not a kid. That's not true. So get your facts straight.
What else do you want to know?
Playoffs? We'll talk about playoffs. You kidding me? Playoffs?
We couldn't do diddly poo offensively. I'm totally embarrassed and totally ashamed. We sucked.
We talking about practice.
If you call me Chris Everett to my face one more time.
Chris?
What's my opinion of Kinga's performance? What the f*** do you think is my opinion of it?
This is the Dan Dakich Show on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Well, you are in trouble this afternoon because DD, the coach, is out on a little family excursion. We know the cookster is already a couple beers deep somewhere in Florida. And that means this voice, Charlie Clifford of Wish TV and Eddie Garrison, are riding with you for the next 3 hours on The Fan. Great to be back. Chris Presley in the building. You listen to Kevin Bowen's podcast. Prez, great to see you. Salute. And to all of you out there, look, today is very important because not only is it gorgeous this afternoon, not only is your weekend about to start tonight, a night early, I feel like today, Eddie Garrison, is the day when everyone gets their sea legs back under them after the 500. Monday was just, we rolled Sunday into Monday, okay? We continued the party. I hope none of you did any work on Monday. Tuesday was recovery mode. Wednesday, you needed to be productive. And then today, you're starting to get the itch again. It's summer in Indianapolis, Indy. Eddie, come on. It's time to get back downtown.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm starting to feel a little normal, getting a couple rested back into me. So feeling somewhat normal. I hope you are as well.
Exactly what I'm getting at, okay? Listen, we waited 3 years for that epic 500. We've waited 3 years to have a normal summer downtown. I know so many of you haven't been down here in way too long. It's time to get back downtown. We did it the last two summers. Hey, come out, support your local businesses, support your local bars and restaurants. There's no reason to take that foot off the gas pedal. This weekend is for you. You did the 500. You crossed that off. You know you have your itinerary for the rest of summer 2022. Weddings, family trips, the 4th. It's going to come quick, people. Take this weekend for you. Treat yourself. Go out. Start it tonight. Tomorrow, you just got to be there in person. You physically got to be at work, okay? And the rest of the weekend is in your hands. We're giving you the hall pass. Start it tonight. And you'll have game one of the finals on as well. We have a full slate today. Again, thank you to Eddie Garrison for lining up what will be a very fun lineup. We're going to get to that in a moment. The first thing I'm starting you with today, and I need your input. So please, if you want to dial us 317-239-1070, I need your thoughts on this. There is arguably one of the boldest preseason predictions for IU basketball, and it is out as of 6:20 last night. Jon Rothstein, for my money, one of the best college basketball voices on Twitter. Okay, he does everything from the small conference stuff to the big boys in the Big Ten. We're taking a look at the Big Ten this coming season. Jon Rothstein's quote, after a couple of Michigan starters decide they're going to keep their names in the NBA draft conversation, the Big Ten officially will go through Bloomington next season, meaning he is picking the Hoosiers as his Big Ten regular season champion favorites. We're still 150 days away. I know that's important, but consider this. The last time a Big Ten team went sub-500 one season, turn around and won the Big Ten Conference Championship in terms of the regular season, that was over 30 years ago. 91, Bob Knight's Hoosiers, okay? Calbert Chaney, Eric Anderson, Damon Bailey came in, still had Greg and Pat Graham. It's been that long, and that stat attributed to Mike LaTulip, 247 Sports, he covers the Illini. Shout out to Mike. Are you telling me that Trace Jackson Davis's return means this much to a team that has not been in the top 25 rankings, guys, since December of Tom Crean's final year. Is the rest of the Big Ten ready to bow down to the Hoosiers? This is where we need to start with your thoughts this morning. Excuse me, this afternoon. What is the bar for IU basketball? Again, 317-239-1070. What is the bar for IU basketball this season? Last year was clear-cut. Get back to the tournament. Mike Woodson's taking over. The team is essentially the same that Archie Miller had, plus a couple transfers, Xavier Johnson being the star pickup of that group. Where is the bar this year? Where will your excitement meter start to go off the charts if they exceed that bar? I'm trying to figure out what's realistic, because when Jon Rothstein, of all people, 315,000 Twitter followers, I know Purdue fans are throwing things out the windows of their cars right now. You're saying, come on, IU's getting all this love because one star player's coming back? Is it that crazy? We're going to break down the eight teams that finished above IU this past season, who they lost, who's coming back, and more importantly, do you think this is actually realistic that IU could go from ninth to first in just one season? So please, Eddie Garrison's going to handle the calls. We're ready to hear your thoughts. What is the bar for IU this season? What is needs to be reached in order for it to be called a successful year two for Mike Woodson? Because Jon Rothstein just set off the alarms. Okay. Now, interestingly enough, his preseason top 25 rankings, the only other top 25 team from the Big Ten, he had IU at 13th, by the way. Okay. So number one in the Big Ten, IU's coming in at 13th. Purdue is that other team, which is going to stun some people. How do the Boilers, who lose Jaden Ivey, who lose Travion Williams, four or five starters gone, and they're still the 19th best team in America? That's not a typo, according to Jon Rothstein. Okay, 19th he has Purdue, and maybe this is the next overachieving Matt Painter squad. We need to circle the point guard spot, though. Who is playing point guard? Remember, Eric Hunter Jr. is a Butler Bulldog now. Is that going to be a bigger loss than so many of you expect? Again, I didn't expect to be talking college basketball this morning when asked to fill in for Dan Dakich. Again, this is Charlie Clifford with you alongside Eddie Garrison today. But when he says something like this, we need to try to take into account the data to make sense of it. Remember, one winning season in Big Ten play over the last 9 years for IU, okay? You have a solid bench, four or five starters coming back, Jalen Hood, Schifino potentially slotting into that shooting guard spot if it won't be Tamar Bates. Where are the shooters coming from is the question. I compare IU a lot to Illinois' team last year. You had Kofi. You have some guards. How far can those guards take you? And ultimately, that's where this is going to lay for me. The Big Ten is wide open. I think that's the conclusion, regardless if you're on the IU or Purdue side of this tweet that came down last night. The Big Ten is wide open, beginning with Wisconsin losing Johnny Davis, Iowa losing Keegan Murray, Kofi's gone, Malachi Barnum at Ohio State's gone, Jaden Ivey, Travion Williams, NBA, Ron Harper Jr., Geo Baker out from Rutgers, Hunter Dickinson is back to Michigan. Michigan State loses Max Christie. That is a ton of talent that disappears from the top eight slots in the Big Ten this past season. And is IU in the right place at the right time, essentially bringing back the same team now for the third consecutive season? You need to make hay. You got to get old and stay old, as Matt Painter would say. And maybe IU is finally taking a page out of that book after convincing itself that, look, we can be Kentucky and be Duke and really just sell out for the one and dones. And that's how this ascension back to the forefront of college basketball is going to happen. Well, the results say that didn't work. That didn't work under Tom Crean. It certainly didn't work with Archie Miller, with Romeo Langford. So, by Trace Jackson Davis staying, by NIL showing up at the exact right time to reward players who are working their tails off at big programs and rightfully have them compensated as Trace Jackson Davis will this season, is this the perfect storm to really have IU return to the forefront of the college basketball conversation. Eddie, how are we looking?
I agree with you. I think it's a very bright future for Indiana, especially if you get that next development and a guy like Tamar Bates, who showed flashes last year. He came up big in the NCAA tournament when he had those couple minutes there at the second half, got him a couple buckets, the same in the Big Ten tournament. But yeah, I agree with you, Charlie. This is an exciting time for Indiana basketball, and you're looking at possibly, when you look at the Big Ten, one of the weakest conferences in a long time. And this is the most opportune time for Indiana to take advantage of that. You're going to be the preseason favorites. You're going to have a lot of expectations, a lot of pressure put on you. So just respond and go out there and play the best basketball you can possibly play.
I wish DD was here for like 5 minutes just to give us, you know, we can almost go to the replay booth. Call the booth. Let's get Dan's thoughts. You're going to have to wait on that for a little bit. Again, DD out today, family trip. My question for you, we can all agree there's excitement. We can all agree the expectations are up. What is the bar? Where can we find the common ground of, all right, this is realistic. This is, if they fall short, if IU falls short of this mark in 2022-2023, it's a disappointing season. If they exceed this mark, then guess what? Mike Woodson's ahead of schedule. Just trying to find some realistic parameters, because for me, I love Jon Rothstein. To me, the fact that he's saying the Big Ten will go through Bloomington this season, 150 days out from when the ball goes up, that is a bit ludicrous considering what we've seen the last 10 years for this program. That could just be me. I would love to see it. I have no dog in the fight. As I've said at Wish TV for 5 years, Purdue, IU, Butler, let them all win. Put three of the four in the Final Four. That would be the greatest thing of all time. I could care less who is ultimately advancing on and getting their day in the sun. But that just jumped off the page to me. Some of the responses, by the way, in Rothstein's comments are hysterical. And the one early that took the cake for me, guys, little Drake meme, one sad Drake with IU finishes eighth in the Big Ten under Archie Miller. And then one happy Drake, you know, looking like he's the king of the club. IU finishes eighth in the Big Ten under Mike Woodson. So we are living in a bit of a vacuum here in terms of, let's remember, they snuck in to that play-in game just a few months ago. Trace Jackson Davis reminded us all that he can be one of the best players in college basketball. The field house was popping. I know, Prez, I know you were, hey, we need to hear that place. We need to see that place packed, making some noise, okay? It's redone. It may be a little bit for the Pacers. I'm all good for any local team that wants to make a run at the Big Ten tournament. But the fact that we're going to tell Tom Izzo, everybody up in Madison, Brad Underwood, Matt Painter, the Fran meter, Chris Holtman, who has four top 100 recruits, Rutgers, who's kicked IU's butt for the last 4 years, and Tom, did I already say Tom Izzo and Juwan? If we're gonna give IU this love, to me, I don't know if I'm Mike Woodson, I don't know if I love that Rothstein tweeted that. Eddie, would you be... Mike Woodson reads that. He obviously smiles. He laughs. I don't think he cares. If you were the head coach, would you want that tagged to IU's name? I know it's a tweet in June. No one's going to remember the opening night of Big Ten play, what was said, but this chatter is only going to build. I'm trying to warm up folks to see what's coming here throughout the summer, throughout the preseason. They're going to play some tough games, but it feels like for a first time in a long time, there's a little heat on IU to actually show up and back it up and not, hey, if they surprise people, that's big. That's a win. This is a totally different conversation that, for me, I have not been a part of since I showed up here 6 years ago. Are you concerned if you're Mike Woodson reading that tweet?
I don't think if you're Mike Woodson, you're concerned. I think if you're an Indiana fan, you're concerned because of the history of the expectations. Of high expectations that is coming into a season and not living up to it. Now, I do think Mike Woodson is the guy that can turn that ship around just because of his background of playing underneath Bob Knight. He has had those expectations on him. He's come from the NBA, so he's seen it all and he's been through it all. And I think he can kind of
almost play into that.
Right.
Use it as a positive.
Right. And Jon Rothstein has Indiana in his top and his preseason rankings as 13th. He's got Purdue 19th. Those are the only two teams from the Big Ten at the top 25. But back to your point, I think the fans themselves should be a little nervous with some pressure on them just because of the history behind it. But if you're Mike Woodson, I don't think you mind it at all because it's something that could fuel the guys to get better. It's like, hey, we've already got these expectations. We have to meet this by practicing well, training well, in the whole nine yards.
I'll tell you one player who is not upset about this or afraid about anything that will be written, said, debated about, and that's Trace Jackson Davis. He knows when in doubt, he can put this team on his back and carry them. He proved that under the most pressure anyone could have been under in an IU uniform at the Big Ten tournament with that deficit against Michigan, and then later with the win over Illinois and the near win over Iowa. I think we can all agree it's just who can shoot on this team. Can Xavier Johnson build off the finish he had the last season? And then you sit back and just start to have some fun again if you're an IU fan. This bench is stacked. Trey Galloway, Jordan Geronimo, Tamar Bates, they can all contribute. The freshman coming in, we know Gunn can shoot coming out of Lawrence North. We'll see who gets minutes in the early going. It's just fun that we have some conjecture and we have, apparently, according to one of college basketball's best voices, in my opinion, the two best teams in the Big Ten are coming from the Hoosier State. That's a beautiful thing. And I think as surprised folks were to hear that IU may be the favorite in the preseason, they're probably just as surprised to hear that Purdue is coming right back up behind them as also considered to be a top 20 team despite losing four or five starters and ultimately not having that point guard position filled out. We have a busy show. Charlie Clifford of Wish TV with you. Jason Dumas of the Bay Area Warriors coverage. He's K-Ron for sports director. He's as close to the Warriors as anyone, really, the past 3 or 4 years. We have game one of the finals, 9 o'clock tip. Jason's going to join us at the top of the hour for not only his expectations for what looks to be another Warriors title, unless you're picking Boston. And more people ahead of tip-off sound like they're more in the middle of this than I originally thought. But we'll get the insight on what's new in Steph Curry's life, also Steve Kerr, and the postseason he's had. There is an incredible Game 1 Steve Kerr stat that we need to give you if you're thinking about laying a little skin in the game tonight. There are some things to think about, which we will pass along. And in addition to that, the broadcast team for Game 1, very much up in the air. This feels like an NFL Sunday with inactives, who's active, COVID-related storylines. We hope everyone's feeling better, but you may have some new voices for the finals tonight chiming in emergency duty. At 1:30, Mark Carmen's going to join us out of Chi-Town. Matt Eberflus, your former defensive coordinator, is he already off to a fast start with Justin Fields? We'll get the details on how Fluce has landed in Chicago and the initial thoughts on the former defensive coordinator becoming a head coach for the first time. Carm's always a blast. He's also had a heck of a week himself, which he'll tell you about. Kevin Bowen, 2 o'clock. I know you watched and listened this morning. Great show with Query. The Maryland coach was fantastic. Really great insight. Nick Cross, a new safety who, you meet Nick Cross, this Colts rookie draft pick. He's 20 years old. He will look you in the eye as if he's a four-time Pro Bowler, and he knows exactly what he's doing on Sundays. I think Chris Ballard has made little secret that they absolutely fell in love with Cross going up to get him in the third round and hearing from his former college head coach. Well, it turns out Coach has a heck of a story himself, which we're going to get into that a little bit later because I thought Jake and KB did a fantastic job really bringing light into one of the more unique coaching journeys that I've come across, not only in the Big Ten, but anywhere in college football in recent memory. Finally rounding it out at 2:30, the champ rejoins us, Marcus Ericsson. He's been around the world and back since Sunday, since his Indy 500 win. We've seen a lot come across the airwaves since then. The television ratings for the Indianapolis 500. I know Jake really got into that this morning. If you have some thoughts on that, we would love to hear that as well. Are you really concerned, or is this just a bunch of noise because ultimately it didn't live up to last year or what have you? We'll get into that, but more curious with Marcus Ericsson. I know so many of you thought it was, all right, that's a nice story. He certainly earned it with the red flag holding on at the end. He's on a fantastic team. You probably know he dabbled in Formula One for 5 years. What else do you know about the Indy 500 champ? Let's talk about his childhood. What does his home life look like growing up? Where does he want to go from here? And of course, all the people he's been meeting with and speaking with since Sunday, the craziest week of his life. We'll get the full recap from Marcus Ericsson as the IndyCar boys head to Detroit this weekend. Charlie Clifford with you, Wish TV, Eddie Garrison, the coach is out on a family trip. Jay Cook is beachside in Florida. We're going to have you covered till 3 o'clock, and there's so much to get to, really, beginning with the finals again at 1 o'clock. I want to pose this question to you too, and maybe we can get this on Twitter, and certainly we're going to need to take some calls at some point. Let's pretend. Let's go into our happy space here. The Pacers are hosting game one of the NBA Finals. It's been the first time in two decades that that finals buzz is in and around this sacred basketball state. And I were to come with you and say, hey, I talked to the mayor, I talked to the governor. We need to throw a pre-game one party, which in essence would start maybe about 4 or 5 o'clock here. We're going to give you one city block. You got to pick what block you want to get blocked off. Who's coming in? What are we doing to really revamp the finals energy that we've all waited for since Reggie went up against the Lakers? Gosh, I just think we're so far removed from how cool of a night this will be in the Bay Area. They've done it 6 out of the last 8 years. I think what we can all appreciate about Warrior fans, who maybe were Warrior fans before Steph and the gang showed up, you know, they aren't the annoying, it's not the Yankees, it's not the Patriots. To me, there is still a lovable element to what will be the best basketball dynasty post Jordan, and certainly a championship this year would keep that flame burning. You know, Hooten, these guys are far from done, so this isn't the last hurrah for this crew. But I really would love to hear your game one plans. If I gave you that prompt, you get a city block, you can bring in any musical entertainment act, you can bring in any MC, just to give us that picture, because I know we're working towards something here with the Pacers, and I think we all believe that better days are ahead, even if this coming season needs to sting a little bit more, maybe even last season did, in order to find those two or three pieces that you can then run with and truly contend in today's NBA. But let's remove ourselves from reality for a moment and envision our city as it currently is. Because let's face it, back when Reggie made that run, this is a different city now. Downtown looks different. And to me, seeing the scenes in Toronto, seeing the scenes in Golden, in the Bay Area, outside of the arenas, that would be us. We would be getting the love, saying, oh my gosh, there's 20,000 additional people outside Gainbridge Fieldhouse. I know you would be one of them. I would gladly be one of them if I didn't have a ticket. And maybe dreaming about that, envisioning it, chatting about it with one another, that can bridge this gap ultimately to getting back there. And hey, it's game one of the finals. We can have some fun. This is where basketball was birthed. So with that being said, Ed, when do I need to take a break? Because how about right now? This is Charlie Clifford coming up next. we give you the top stat of game one of the NBA Finals, plus a little bit later, Colts OTAs. How is Matt Ryan look? Why is he different maybe than Phillip Rivers from what we've seen so far in OTAs? We'll be back on The Fan after this.
Hey, it's Big Joe, and Ryan Kelly is with us on the line. 317-550-1515 is the number to call to get a hold of him, or thehomeloanexpert.com also works. And Ryan, taking care of our military, past and present, we know that's really important to you. So much so, you developed the Hero Loan to help out our brave men and women.
Absolutely. Big Joe, it means the world to us, the sacrifices that these folks make to protect our freedoms to live in this great nation. And that's why we created the Hero Loan, only available at HeroLoan.com. We got at a table. We sat down. We brainstormed. What can we do to give back? We had already been working through the desert. We've already been climbing mountains to raise money for Fisher House. I mean, the list goes on, but we had to do more. And that was the birth of the Hero Loan. We will get you a lower rate on your VA loan. We will pay for your appraisal, help with all the paperwork, and can close your VA loan in as little as 21 days. No one else does that. Get the loan that you deserve today. Visit HeroLoan.com, the only way to VA.
Helzberg Diamonds presents The Guy Who Got It Right. Tim needed an engagement ring. He did research, listened to hints from his fiancée's friends.
She wants a lab-grown, oval-cut, and white gold with a halo.
And he went to Helzberg Diamonds. At Helzberg, Tim found an incredible selection of high-quality, lab-grown, and natural diamonds. He also found the ring she really wanted.
Nailed it. She is gonna freak.
Be like Tim. Find the ring of her dreams at a Helzberg near you or at Helzberg.com. Ask now about special financing offers.
911, what's your emergency?
Por favor, necesito ayuda. Está volando y creo que me va a pegar otra vez.
I will get someone to speak with you. Please stay on the line.
Hola, tengo su ubicación. Ayuda está en camino.
Getting past a language barrier is critical when first responders help Hoosiers. That's why the State 911 Board provides special tools for non-English speaking citizens to communicate with emergency services.
Si estás en peligro, aunque no hables inglés, podrás recibir ayuda en una emergencia rápidamente.
All Indiana 911 centers began offering translation services in over 240 languages in 2019. Now people can send text messages for help in their native language to 911 and receive a translated text back from the dispatcher. It's of great help to the deaf and speech impaired, and to those in select dangerous situations.
Cuando llame o envíe un texto al 911, un servicio de traducción se asegurará que entiendan lo que está diciendo.
For more information, visit in911.net.
Gracias, gracias.
911. Before you text, voice is best.
We're the most active season of the year right now, but if you have joint pain, you can't live like you want to. Whether it's, you know, heading to the zoo, walking on the canal, attending an Indians game, hip pain, knee pain, back pain, shoulder pain, it sucks the fun out of living. I'm Kevin Bowen, and I've got some fantastic news for you, though. QC Kinetics is helping the people get the fun back with advanced regenerative treatments from local professionals right here in Indy, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. We're talking regenerative medicine. It's the hottest thing going. It's basically a growth factors with healing properties from your own body, highly concentrated, then putting them into your aching joints. It's exciting. In-office, non-surgical treatment can repair and restore damaged tissue in your joints, giving you real, lasting relief from pain. QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in these cutting-edge, all-natural options, and the patient satisfaction reports are incredible. Yes, you can get real relief from pain with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. So call QC Kinetics 463-235-7160. Again, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood.
At Diamonds Direct right now, there's nothing standing in your way of owning the piece of jewelry you've been dreaming of. No down payment and no finance charges for 5 whole years on any purchase. Take the amazing Diamonds Direct price you're used to, divide by 60, and that's your payment. It's a smart way to buy. Keep your money in your pocket and still add that amazing ring, band, or bracelet to your collection. Even the upgrade you've been wanting. 5 years, zero interest on any purchase. Only at Diamonds Direct. Get all the details at DiamondsDirect.com. Unapproved credit.
Follow The Fan on social media. The Fan is on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Like and follow The Fan to stay up to date on all of our giveaways and all things sports.
Everybody needs a man cave.
Ours just happens to be a little bigger than most.
All right, let's not go there. Let's just invite them to our place.
We're getting together for a night in the fan cave, brought to you by Forum Credit Union on June 23rd. We'll chat about sports, tell lies, and talk smack.
We'll start the evening down in the Larceny Lounge with munchies, beer, and plenty of Larceny and Evan Williams bourbon.
This is going to be a heck of a party and a show rolled into one.
Tickets are on sale now at 1075thefan.com.
The Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
How we doing? Charlie Clifford back with you. Wish TV in for the coach today. You're just joining us. IU basketball is what has us very, very chatty this afternoon. Big Ten favorites preseason, according to Jon Rothstein, after now we know where all the stars from one season ago, whether they're coming back to school or heading to the NBA. We broke it down 1-8 at the top of the show. The eight teams that finished above IU, the only team in the Big Ten that gets its best two players back from one season ago, are the Hoosiers. That is why Matt is on the phone. Matt, what's the bar for IU in 2022? What's realistic?
Well, first of all, speaking of Jon Rothstein, he blocked me on...
Oh, great. So this is your shot to try to have him unblock you. We'll clip it and we'll tweet it at Rothstein. Give me a reason why he should unblock you.
So the only reason he did is because he made all these custom shirts. You know how he has all these slogans for the different programs?
Right.
He used like the official school logos and had all these slogans on t-shirts. And I just responded and said, like, did you get licensing approval for all these shirts? Kind of a soft move, you know, to be honest. I love Jon Rothstein, though. So I have, like, a burner account that I still follow along, you know?
Smart. But, and I feel like he will forgive you. You know, sometimes you just got to understand where people are coming from, and we're gonna get you back on his account so you can ditch the burner, right?
Yeah. So, IU, I think, like, the bar, you asked, like, what's the bar for fans?
Right.
I think you have to at least compete in the Big Ten.
Come on, Matt. I need more than compete, though. We're all using the same words, compete, excited. We need details.
So, okay, top three of the Big Ten and win road games against the other top teams in the Big Ten.
I love the road game aspect because, I mean, we can count on one hand how many big-time road wins they've had the past few years, right? I remember with Romeo, they beat Michigan State on the road 1 year. Gosh, it's been few and far between, though. They haven't won Wisconsin in a millennium. I like that. I think that's realistic. I think top three gives you a little wiggle room. I'm just worried, Matt, that until you see them not hit that road bump in February and March, how are we going to say they're the Big Ten favorites? It just seems like a stretch.
Yeah, that's the part of the season where they're going to prove if they're for real. So I think all the fans would agree if they get some tough road wins against other really solid Big Ten teams during those months, then Woodson's going to have the full approval of all the fans.
Matt, Trace Jackson Davis is your favorite player since who wore an IU uniform?
Well, I went to Center Grove, so it's hard. I'll say Johnny Marlin because he went to Center Grove too.
Boom. Trojans. We have our Trojans insider here. That's cool, man. I think, you know, we need to enjoy this. Who, obviously, Purdue fans will not, but for fans of just college basketball, a homegrown Indianapolis area kid, who has a chance to be one of the best players in college basketball for a season. I mean, that doesn't come around every year. I think we need to take a moment and really soak that in this year. I'm sure, I know obviously IU fans will, but I think that's a cool storyline for college basketball in general.
Yeah, a little backstory about Trace. My younger brother went to Greenwood Christian Academy and played a few years of high school basketball, and Trace was there in middle school. And my brother said there was this like awkwardly tall kid that would be doing like post drills on the other side of the court, and he wasn't any good. You know, and they knew his name was Trace, but like nobody on the court, which none of his teammates went to, you know, big time college basketball or anything.
Yeah.
But they had no clue that this like future All-American was this eighth grader, you know.
No, man, I love it. And that's a great insight. I'll be honest with you. I watched him play in high school. Obviously, anyone who sat in the gym and watched Trace Jackson Davis play in Center Grove knew two things. He could jump out of the gym. And there was potential, but I didn't see this happening. I know many people question motor. Hey, does he really want it? And clearly when he showed up in Bloomington from day one, there was a switch that flipped, and because he's been outstanding in terms of rebounding and blocking shots and doing all the little things in addition to scoring since he showed up. I mean, that's been from day one. So I think shout out to Center Grove. And as you said, everyone who helped along a young, tall, maybe awkward kid become who will be one of the top players in the college game this season. Appreciate the call, Matt.
Yeah. Thanks for taking my call. See ya.
Absolutely. So there's the bar. I think that's a good place to start. Top three in the Big Ten. Again, if you're just joining us, Charlie Clifford in for the coach today. What is realistic for IU this season? This comes after Jon Rothstein, college basketball insider for CBS Sports, said last night, taking inventory of the entire conference, it appears on paper the Hoosiers should be the team to beat in the Big Ten in 2022-2023. We listed the stat. How hard is that to do coming from a team that finished with a sub-500 record one season before? The last team to win the Big Ten after being 500 or less 1 year prior was Bob Knight's Indiana Hoosiers in 1991. That's when Damon Bailey showed up to help Calbert Chaney, who just went off, scored 21-plus. Eric Anderson, Greg and Pat Graham, fantastic. That's how long it's been. This is not the SWAC. This is not the Valley. This is very hard to go from ninth to first overnight. And we've talked about a multitude of factors. Maybe this is the right time. NIL's come in play. That kept Trace Jackson Davis certainly to some degree from leaving for the NBA. They've won the transfer battle so far. Obviously, picking up Xavier Johnson, he is the second most important player. Some would argue come March, he will be IU's most important player. A top 10 recruiting class. Three, four guys that could see minutes if they earn them. Certainly, physically, they appear ready to play at the college level. And then a bench that you've built out now since the beginning, I should say since the Archie Miller era. These are guys that Archie recruited, and Trey Galloway, Jordan Geronimo, Tamar Bates, they can have an impact behind Miller Kopp and Thompson and TJD in the starting lineup. So please, if you still have more thoughts on what that bar is for IU, you just heard Matt's opinion. We appreciate that. Also, who's the most likely to emerge behind Race, Trace, and Xavier Johnson as that scorer on the wing? Because if you spent any amount of time watching IU basketball this past season, the shooting from the outside is still the question mark. And until that's addressed with a consistent knockdown shooter, you think about Plummer and what he did for Illinois this past season, I just think we need to temper our expectations a tad based on what Rothstein put out there last night. Let's take a look at the NBA Finals. Again, Charlie Clifford with you for the coach today. He's out on a family trip. Jay Cook is on the beach in Florida. Eddie Garrison is at the controls. Game one tonight, we have a late tip. 9 o'clock on the West Coast, Celtics, Warriors. Jason Dumas covering the Warriors is going to join us momentarily. The Celtics come in as the underdog in terms of winning the series. Experience is with the Warriors. Celtics do not have a player that's played in the NBA Finals. The Warriors have a combined 123 games of finals experience. They're back in the finals for the sixth time in 8 years. Steve Kerr, we told you leading into the last break, he is not the coach you want to face for game ones. Steve Kerr is 21-2 in game ones as a head coach. I'm not feeling great if I'm a Celtics fan reading that. Now, if you got a little skin in the game today, later tonight, I should say, Boston, the best team so far this postseason against the spread, 11-5-1. So Boston's carried its weight in terms of looking at that spread and ultimately taking care of business, keeping games close, winning games they weren't expected to win, and ultimately bouncing back after losses. That's why this series is going to go at least six based on these numbers. Boston 14-3 following its last 17 losses. They have not lost back-to-back games since late March. They are not a team that lays down. Marcus Smart, Jason Tatum, Jaylen Brown. That is not a core that is going to look inward and pout and let things snowball. They've backed it up. Al Horford, can they do enough in the middle of the lane to get out on Golden State shooters and also protect the play, protect the paint, excuse me. We saw Dallas was atrocious at that. Dallas came in after stunning the Suns and simply couldn't guard anyone. And that was over very quickly. Will Boston having to play a game 7 against Miami and then travel out west, will that carry over? This is a fun finals, Eddie. I think, look, Boston hasn't won enough for people to really despise them. Golden State trying to catch a second wave, third wave, really, of this dynasty. Do you get a sense that anyone outside of maybe Knicks fans who hate the Celtics or people who maybe are closer to the Warriors than we are doesn't like this matchup? Because I'm very happy with this matchup that we're going to get for the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, I'm very happy too. I'm interested to see the defensive matchups because you'll have Klay Thompson on Jaylen Brown. You'll have Andrew Wiggins on Jason Tatum. You'll have Marcus Smart on Steph Curry. So, I mean, it's going to be fun to watch. I totally agree with you there. And here's another little factoid. In the NBA Finals, when the line is 6 or less, the winner is 62-0-1. Meaning they've covered the spread in 62 of the 63 games with one push.
That's insane.
Golden State is favored by 4.5 tonight.
Wow. Well.
And that's dating back to 2008.
Hey, thank you for digging that up. That's a little hard to believe. I mean, but the line tonight, as you said, is 4.5. Okay. So we need to take note of that. This is to be taken into account as well. The Warriors are 9-0 at home this postseason. Okay, now Boston, if I remember correctly, just went into South Beach and beat a Heat team who hadn't lost at home either, but
I think they beat them twice too.
Heat fans and Warrior fans, come on. There's no comparison. I mean, this playing a road game in Miami is about as nice of a place as you'll visit in the postseason, correct?
Oh, I agree. Plus, I don't know to you, Charlie. When I was watching those games in Miami, it just felt like the Heat fans weren't engaged. Like, the crowd was dead.
Have they ever been engaged? Even at the peak of LeBron's era? I mean, it's been the easiest fan base to That's just true. Hit with, like, a pinata. They're, be more obvious. Tell me in more ways that you have a million other things you could be doing right now and you're just here to take an Instagram and go home. I don't, you know, that's Miami, man. There's people to do. There's places to see. And going to a Heat game, you know, no one's going home crying after the Heat lost Game 7. If the Pacers just lost Game 7, this city would still be in mourning. We would have the lights off in this studio. We would have the curtains drawn outside of this beautiful, sunny Thursday afternoon. We wouldn't feel right for months.
Right.
And instead, Miami's already forgotten that Game 7. You know, oh, Sunday night, yeah, that wasn't great. That's just how it goes, and that's why we need to get a playoff team back here, man. It stinks when we have no hoops to talk about once the Final Four is done. And I know we have the draft, and I know this is just part of the process now that we're all signed up for. Everybody's in on this, okay? This is the right thing to do. Find young pieces. You have a nice core structurally for this organization. Now you need to find the talent. And we were talking off air. Look, we've talked so much about IU this season. Jaden Ivey is going to be a household name here in a few weeks. What are you hearing, Eddie, about Ivey's latest draft chatter? Because to me, he's worth taking 2 or 3. Forget these big guys. Look at these teams. Look at how they're winning. You need skill on the wings, and everything else you can just fill in. I will be stunned if Ivy falls to 4. I will be stunned.
The one player I would take over Ivy is Paolo Banchero, simply because he can handle the ball, and you can put him anywhere 1 through 5 defensively. But I would put Ivy up there with Jabari Smith, certainly over Chet Holmgren. But I would say Ivy could go as late as 5, but I don't think he would get past Indiana at 6 if he made it there.
He's not going to get to 6. It's a pipe dream. And that's what stung so much about the draft lottery. If you could have just get me to four and we'll figure something out. Get me, oh my God. I mean, it's the luck of the lotto there. And unfortunately, I just don't see Ivy falling to six. And I know so many Purdue fans are nodding along right now as they drive along on this gorgeous Thursday afternoon. But game one, we will have our full conversation just 15 minutes away. Jason Dumas of K-Ron Sports in the Bay Area. He writes for Bleacher Report, national level coverage for a local star out in the Bay Area on TV. We will get the pregame pulse. He'll be at the Chase Center tonight. And then a quick rundown of our later lineup today. Mark Carman out of Chi-Town at 1:30. Matt Eberflus, your former defensive coordinator. Are Bears fans a little lukewarm on the new Bears head coach? Carm will clear that up. Kevin Bowen, 2 o'clock. You listened to Kevin and Jake this morning. Kevin is on the inside of what's happening at Colts OTAs once again this week, ahead of minicamp next week. And early impressions of Matt Ryan along with who may emerge this summer. And then we'll round it out with, once again, the man on top of the racing world, Marcus Ericsson, who is en route to Detroit. I believe he's there now. He was in New York City celebrating the BorgWarner spoils that have just begun for a Swede who is really taking off now that we're fully aware of how good he was. There's a great article posted today that we're going to get into just how great he's been the last year. And now the numbers are finally, showing up for a 500 champion. Sometimes you got to make a big splash for us to realize exactly how good you've been. This is Charlie Clifford on 107.5 The Fan, in for the coach. We will be back previewing not only game one, but we need to take a look towards the Colts and this summer. Who is already sticking out at OTAs, a name you need to keep an eye on? Those details are ahead.
Do you need air conditioning service and are looking for a local dealer you can trust, like Marshall Mechanical in Franklin? Find that American Standard Air dealer at IndyHomeComfort.com.
Hey, it's JMV for BullseyeEventGroup.com and the best pregame party anywhere. The Colts are going to Vegas this year, and so can you. The official Colts Las Vegas fan travel package is a private air charter with hundreds of Colts fans. That means no stops, no layovers, a direct flight. Leave Indy Saturday morning, return Monday afternoon. Two-night weekend travel package at Caesars Palace. Tickets to the Colts and the Raiders game included. The official Colts Las Vegas fan travel package includes admission into the official Colts tailgate in Vegas, Vegas style. Book your spot now. BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Hey, tennis fans, with the BetRivers.com sportsbook app, you can smash, slice, and spin your way to big tennis paydays. That's because we're serving up the excitement of live in-game betting, where you can bet on all the action, including point-by-point betting from tournaments around the world. Plus, with BetRivers' award-winning customer service, it's game, set, and match. Download the BetRivers.com sportsbook app. It's a whole new game.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Spectrum is America's leading internet provider, delivering ultra-fast gig speeds you need on the high-performance network you want. And Spectrum's advanced home Wi-Fi is security made simple, automatically blocking outside threats, along with 99.9% network reliability. So no matter what you do online, you can do it faster, safer, and more reliably with Spectrum Internet. Get 200 megabits per second for only $49.99 a month. Visit Spectrum.com today for details. Based on internet subscribers among top internet service providers, restrictions apply.
Were you born from 1945 to 1965? People born during these years are 5 times more likely to have hepatitis C. But most people don't know they are infected. So even if you try to eat right, exercise, and take care of yourself, you can still have hepatitis C, a serious liver disease that often has no symptoms. In fact, people can live with hepatitis C for decades without feeling or looking sick. But over time, hepatitis C can cause serious health problems, including liver damage, liver failure, or even liver cancer. Getting tested is the only way to know if you're infected with hepatitis C. That's why the CDC recommends everyone born from 1945 to 1965 get a blood test for hepatitis C. Treatments are available that can cure this disease. So talk to your doctor about getting tested. It could save your life.
A message from the CDC.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan. It's the Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Let's go! Sunday, first weekend of June's here. As we begged you at the top of the show, please, this is the weekend for you. Treat yourself. Just go be you before you have all the obligations of the summer. Weddings, family trips, the 4th. This is you and Indy, man. We've waited 3 years to just enjoy this city and all it has to offer as it continues to just blossom downtown. I talked to so many friends. Oh, gosh, I haven't been downtown in 2 years. It's been 2 summers. I couldn't tell you more than one restaurant. That's ridiculous. That is absolutely ridiculous. Tonight's the night to start it. This is your weekend to just start summer the right way after I know you're feeling better than you did Monday morning. And I know you're feeling better than you did Tuesday morning. So no excuses. You've gotten your work done. You've punched the clock. You've shown face. And now summer, as we've waited for way too long, is finally back as it should be. This is Charlie Clifford of Wish TV. Eddie Garrison is attempting to steer me in the proper direction today. Coach is out. He's living his best life with the fam, which we love to hear. And at the top of the hour, Jason Dumas of K-Ron Sports is joining us from the Bay Area to talk game one of the NBA Finals. That is the top ticket item tonight. We did want to pass along an IndyCar update that broke just about an hour ago. If you follow the series very closely, specifically one of the top dogs in the series, this doesn't come as a shock, but the timing is just interesting as we're approaching the midway mark of the season. These news nuggets come out earlier and earlier in IndyCar every year. Changes for drivers in terms of who they are driving for in the following season, they come early. You do not wait till the offseason in IndyCar anymore. Alexander Rossi is officially out at Andretti Autosport. He's going to McLaren, and it sounds like he may not be the only one going to McLaren, although as of right now, that's the only confirmed update we have. So Pato Award, Alexander Rossi, that'll be, as of now, your 1-2 punch for next season for McLaren. 7 years with Andretti for Rossi. Got a big extension. I want to say it was 19 going into 20, where, yes, Colton Herta was a name that many believed was going to have promise, as he has. He's been the only Andretti winner since he's shown up and joined the team. That is Colton Herta. And Rossi, for those of you who know the talent, appreciate his fearless approach. And as you saw on Sunday, again, there are very few drivers who are better at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway than Alexander Rossi. Unfortunately, everywhere else, the bad luck, the crazy breaks, the just poor showings piled up, and that led to this ultimate breakup with Andretti. I would say landing on his feet is the right terminology, though, to go to McLaren, Eddie. It's not like he's out of a seat, which none of us expected. Your thoughts on the timing of this move? The guy has to go race for Andretti this weekend. I know once the green flag drops, he's not going to be thinking about that. But that's like telling an NBA player, hey, you're going to play for the Nets next season. Sorry.
Right, right.
Please keep hustling for us, though. Keep diving after those loose balls.
It is interesting in terms of the timing. And Kyle Kirkwood will be replacing Alexander Rossi in the 27 machine next year for Andretti Autosport. So I thought it's interesting, and when you look at how Aero McLaren did in the 500, Felix Rosenquist and Pato Award both right there at the end.
That's a great point.
And if you're Alexander Rossi, you're wanting to get back to winter victory lane or whatever victory circle, I think is what they call it now,
correct.
Right? So you're trying to get back there, and Arrow McLaren has had some promising cars the last couple of seasons. You look at Pato O'Ward, he looks like he's one of the more up-and-coming drivers. I would want to work with a guy like Pato, learn from him, and maybe even teach him a couple things along the same way to get him where he wants to go.
Two of the most talented drivers, no question, Rossi and O'Ward, and that isn't hell of a 1-2 punch if you're McLaren trying to figure out your long-term plan, knowing that O'Ward has publicly shared his aspirations to drive in Formula One. And Felix Rosenqvist, despite his top five finish at the 500, we now know it would have likely taken a win for him to keep his seat. And I think technically that hasn't been decided yet, but there is some writing on the wall there, it appears, after this move. But Kyle Kirkwood, hey, there are believers at Andretti that he can be fantastic. And he was very steady this past month. He did not get caught up in any rookie mistakes in terms of putting that thing into the wall. I thought he blended it. I thought he drove very well. And it was interesting because I caught up with Rossi immediately after the 500. You know, that's one of the best parts about the 500 is you can connect with these guys almost instantaneously after they climb out of the race cars. And Michael Andretti and Rossi had what appeared to be a very, respectful conversation after that. And I would assume part of it was Andretti telling Rossi how much he appreciated that performance under the circumstances. And, he fought from the back of the pack to finish fifth and did it, we had so many names. Hey, they're going to start in the back. They can work their way forward. No one did it better on Sunday than Rossi, and life in IndyCar moves pretty quickly, as we found out today with the move Rossi to McLaren, Kirkwood to Andretti. Eddie, do we need a timeout before we catch with Jason Dumas? We're going to be back game one of the finals. Why the Warriors should be heavy favorites tonight in your mind. We're going to the Bay Area next. This is Charlie Clifford on 107.5 The Fan.
Everybody needs a man cave.
Ours just happens to be a little bigger than most.
All right, let's not go there. Let's just invite them to our place.
We're getting together for a night in the fan cave, brought to you by Forum Credit Union on June 23rd. We'll chat about sports, tell lies, and talk smack.
We'll start the evening down in the Larceny Lounge with munchies, beer, and plenty of Larceny and Evan Williams bourbon.
This is going to be a heck of a party and a show rolled into one.
Tickets are on sale now at 107.5thefan.com.
Buy four ultimate washes and get two free is back at Crew Car Wash. Washbooks make great gifts for dad this Father's Day. Available online and all Crew Car Wash locations.
BSN Sports is the business of providing your favorite teams their uniforms, sporting goods, and sportswear. That said, they're also fans themselves. And this year, the excitement around high school sports, it's at an all-time high. BSN Sports continuing to support our student-athletes, coaches, and schools by recognizing the great teams in our area with the BSN Sports 107.5, the Fan High School Team of the Week. Three teams will be chosen per week, and then your Twitter votes will pick the winner. Let the voting begin. Follow BSN Sports on Twitter at @BSN_Indy to help support your favorite student-athletes.
When a health system treats patients with the very best in medical care and compassion, it needs a rare kind of staff. That's why Eskenazi Health never stops looking for professionals who understand that technology is most effective when paired with a genuine human touch. If you are
a nurse,
a social worker,
or another professional interested in a career with us, visit eskenazihealth.edu/careers. Eskenazi Health, one of Becker's 150 great places to work in healthcare.
Meet Edwina. She loves summers in Indy, but hates to paint year after year, so she called Rhino Shield.
So over the years, I've had to touch up the house. I just got to the point where I couldn't spend any more money on the outside of the house. And when I saw Rhino Shield, I thought that was the answer to my problem.
And Rhino Shield's not paint. It's better.
I've had painters here before, and it was usually quite a disaster with them leaving their equipment here and picking up things in the yard. But Rhino Shield was right on it.
Indy, get the 25-year guaranteed protection of Rhino Shield right now for 10% off the regular price.
The gentleman said, if you're interested, give me a call. And I said, honestly, can you come tomorrow?
Here's owner Shane Smith.
This offer is limited, so call me at 888-RHINO-41. That's 888-RHINO-41.
Don't paint.
Don't vinyl.
Go Rhino. Rhino.
Don't paint. Don't vinyl. Go Rhino Shield. Never paint your house again. Rhino Shield.
Message to Amy Spin Class. Happy 3rd 29th birthday, Amy! Exclamation point. Ha ha. Balloon emoji. Balloon emoji. Balloon emoji.
You're good at voice to text.
Pizza emoji.
We're good at your insurance. Find an Indiana Farm Bureau insurance agent online, over the phone, or in person. And stop knocking on wood.
This Sunday, the streets of Belle Isle, the IndyCar Chevrolet Detroit Grand Prix. On 93.5, 107.5, The Fan at 3 p.m. Coverage brought to you by the Speedrome and Circle City Raceway.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
IndyCar races through the streets of Belle Isle at the Detroit Grand Prix. Sunday at 3 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Today is gonna be the day that they're gonna throw it back to you.
It's the Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Let's roll. NBA Finals Game 1, Warriors Celtics, 9 Eastern tip. Warriors favored anywhere from 3.5 to 4.5 right now. The man who gives you national-esque coverage from the local level, Jason Dumas, K-Ron Bay Area sports anchor. He's also writing for Bleacher Report. No one's been closer to the Warriors in the last few years. JD, I appreciate you hopping on and have ultimate respect for what you crank out. It seems like at times it's a one-man show out there, but you would never know with what you put out there. So job well done on the Warriors beat, man.
Thank you, man. Appreciate the kind words, and thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. What's the pulse tonight? Everyone out here expects the Warriors to take care of business. We've seen Steve Kerr's record in game ones. Why should you be concerned, potentially, if you're a Warrior fan? Give me your thoughts ahead of tip-off.
Well, you should be concerned because the Celtics are a really good team, for one, obviously. But they also pose a couple matchup problems for Golden State. You know, historically, the teams who Golden State has struggled with are physical, lengthy teams. That's kind of Boston's MO. They
sure.
They got size and length on the wing with Tatum Brown and Smart, and then they got size and length in the paint with Horford and Robert Williams. You know, they could pose some problems for them. They blew the Warriors out in March. Granted, Steph Curry only played 14 minutes that game because Marcus Smart rolled on his left foot.
Oh, we remember that, JD.
Yeah, that put Steph out for the rest of the regular season. He actually didn't come back until game one of the playoffs, and he came on off the bench. That seems like so long ago. But, Boston – They pose a lot of matchup problems for the Warriors, and you know, it's just like a boxing match. It's kind of like it's a matchup based. So
right,
Dub Nation knows that out here, and they're still pretty confident, but that's why you would be nervous going into game one.
Jason Dumas, K-Ron Sports. That's local Bay Area television, Warriors beat reporter, Bleacher Report. How has the Chase Center been this postseason? We've seen the Warriors are unbeatable so far on their home floor. What's that arena been like? Because this has been the first big run they've had since leaving Oakland, correct?
Yeah. Yeah, they had two down seasons in their first 2 years at Chase Center. One, they had the worst record. First year, they had the worst record in basketball. And then the second year, which was last year, you know, it was kind of disrupted by COVID. And they made it to the play-in game, and they lost a home play-in game to Memphis and failed to make the playoffs. It's been better than expected, to be honest. Chase Center, it's one of these new arenas where there's so much to do inside the arena, the luxury suites, the full bars. So it's easy to take away people away from the action because they're not in their seat. They're
right.
They're at this little like luxury suite bar, you know. But it's been loud. It's I don't think it's ever going to be the old Oracle Arena out
right.
out in Oakland. This is kind of more of a wine and cheese crowd. A lot of people have been priced out. Unfortunately, a lot of people have been priced out. It still gets loud, though.
Yeah.
But even Steph Curry and them will tell you, let's stay away from the comparisons.
Hey, that's probably for the best. And it's interesting because every new arena that gets built, hey, nothing was as loud as Market Square was back in the day. Nothing was as loud as the old Chicago Stadium. I feel like that's just kind of how it goes, but hey, this is a chance to make people remember why Dub Nation is one of the best fan bases in the country, regardless of the sport. I love the question. If you're just joining us, this is Jason Dumas, West Coast reporter for the Warriors. I love the response from Steph, I should say, when you asked him, hey, how has your perspective changed heading into this finals as opposed to walking into your first NBA finals? Why did you feel the need to go there with him? And please share what he had on that question.
Yeah, you know, Steph, he's really, you could tell this year he's really just been enjoying the journey. That first, the 5 years straight when they went to the finals, you could tell in 2019 at the end of that finals, one, you could tell it felt like it was the end of some sort of era. You just knew KD was leaving.
Yeah.
But you could also tell, like, honestly, that team was not even that enjoyable to cover. There was a lot of tension in the air all season, a lot of passive aggressiveness. Steve Kerr even alluded to that fact. So you could tell then they had their little 2 years of limbo. Steph missed that basically the whole year. I think he played 4 or 5 games the year he broke his hand. And then last year, even though they lost in the play-in round, the final 20 games of the season, they went 15-5. And they make the playoffs if LeBron James doesn't hit this crazy fadeaway three-pointer with right. a hand in his face in that first play-in game. But you could tell they were starting to build something. They had found something. At the end of last season. And Steph heard all the noise about can he lead championship team anymore? Is his reign over? And, you know, so I think he took this year to really appreciate the journey. Klay Thompson came back. And, you know, even Klay, like, you appreciate basketball a little more when you
– Oh, gosh, with what he's been through? Yeah.
Yeah, so – yeah. I think just with all the context, it brought them back together. Steph, Klay, and Draymond kind of just went back to the built drawing board. They figured out how can we get back to where we want to get. Bob Myers did a fantastic job building a team around them.
Jordan Poole
stepping up, and some of these rookies who are playing. Moses Moody was a guy they brought in, or not Moses Moody. Otto Porter Jr. was a guy they brought in. So I just wanted to ask Steph, like, you know, like, talk about this journey and that, and how was it from the first time you went to a finals until now? And he just, you know, that was kind of his answer. Just he appreciates everything about this team and everything he's been through. He loves the fact that his kids are now old enough to kind of
right.
really, really understand basketball, at least the two oldest girls, you know, so they can comprehend what they're watching now and talk to him about it. So it just really was all encompassing, and he was just kind of enjoying the moment. And you even saw him yesterday at media day out in the practice court. He kind of just sat on the sidelines for a little bit and wasn't doing anything. He was just very reflective of the moment.
That's cool. Ahead of a finals, let alone we saw Twitter video like 2 days ago. He was walking out of a Golf Galaxy with a new set of irons. Did you catch that?
I did not catch that. I mean, I saw the pictures, but he did tell us that he got some golf in.
Okay.
So when the Celtics were traveling, when the Celtics were traveling back from Miami to Massachusetts, which I thought was so crazy. I thought it would have been smarter for them just to go to Miami to San Francisco.
That's crazy. I didn't know that. They went home and then doubled back out west?
Yeah, they went home first. But that first day, their flight from Miami to Boston, Steph was out on the links playing golf. So the Warriors will definitely be more well-rested than Boston.
That's a page out of MJ's book right there. I love it. Give me insight covering Draymond Green. What's it like? Because that's one of the beneficial things we get on NBA Beats, covering teams. And I don't need to explain what folks see on social media from Draymond. You know when he gets teed up. You know when he drops a bombshell comment. But day to day, what's Draymond like?
Man, he's pretty much as you expect. He's definitely the best soundbite on the team. he's very media friendly too. You know, even though he's like entrenched in his own media thing now because he's does this podcast and he takes a lot of pride in it. It's not something he just like shows up and does. He's very, very strategic and he has a fleet of producers. It's funny, he'll even ask us about topics that he wants to talk about on his and he'll be like advice. So what do you think? How do you think this will play out on the pod? And so Draymond's honestly, he probably is my favorite cover on the team. He's very accessible. You know, and he's just your common dude. You know, he was a second round draft pick. People told him he was too fat to play in the NBA. They called him a tweener. So he came in with that chip on his shoulder, and he's still really that guy. Like, you know, some guys, they get to the NBA, they get to the status, they're making nine figures, and they kind of feel unapproachable. Draymond Green is really that guy who just seems like one of the dudes. And, you know, I've appreciated covering him for the last 4 years. He's become a really close, for lack of a better word, colleague, I should say, because we chat a lot and it's been cool.
No, it's no surprise. And that's a real testament to what you've turned out on the content side, on air, digitally. Again, this is Jason Dumas out of K-Ron, the Bay Area. Please give him a follow on Twitter. This is going to be a wild series. I think it goes minimum six. We were listing off some stats earlier, JD, about Boston hasn't lost back-to-back games since late March. They're, you know, obviously the experiences in Golden State's court. Steve Kerr's like 21-2 in game one, so I wouldn't hold your breath for the Celtics stealing one off the bat. How do you gauge this thing going? Because we forgot you guys, you know, when was that last game against Dallas? You whipped through the Mavs, no problem. Luka gets sent home. We're just all interested to see how these first couple games go with Boston having to go the distance with Miami as opposed to what the Warriors just had to do against the Mavs.
Yeah, so that game was the 26th of May. So it was a week from today. It was last Thursday. I think the Warriors are going to take this, and I agree with you. I think it's going to be a long series. I picked the series in seven. The key for Boston is to get one of these games in San Francisco, because if they don't split and chase and they go back to TD Garden down 2-0, that's when I think it could get over in a hurry and it could be five, because just like you said, Steve Curry's only lost one game one in his career. That was to the Oklahoma City Thunder in 2016, and they actually still ended up winning that series. But they've also won a road playoff game in 26 straight series. So you can almost bet that they're going to go to Boston and take at least one. So if Boston goes back to TD Garden down 2-0, you can got to assume at the end of those two in Boston, it'll be 3-1. And, you know, that's just a hole that's hard to dig yourself out of. So the key to Boston is really going to be winning one of these first two games, either tonight or on Sunday in San Francisco. And if they do that, I see this thing going seven. But I do see ultimately the Warriors winning. I think they're just a little bit better of a team, more talented, not by far, but they have more talent,
yeah,
deeper. they have the experience. And also Boston, they played two game sevens in the last two series. I think they're going to be running on fumes. Marcus Smart is a little banged up. Robert Williams is a little banged up. Meanwhile, the Warriors seem to be getting their banged up players back. So I think all that combination leans to the Warriors in this series.
That's big. That's big. Charlie Clifford in for the coach today. JD, who loses their cool first, Smart or Green?
I got to go Dre. Dre will pick up a tech at some point along the line.
I just don't, come on, let's face it. Celtics fans are not pleasant folks. And I could see, especially coming back 0-2, they know our only shot in this series is if we get under Dre's skin and something crazy happens. I'm interested to see what happens when that thing goes back out east, too. That's when the series really starts, in my opinion.
Yeah, you know, that's the old adage. A series doesn't start until you lose a home game.
Right, right. Now, for our sake, I hope we get a series here, man, because I think the Warriors, as kind of as clean as it's been, run through the West, you know, for them to really have their comeback moment, you don't want to sweep a team, right? We want to see a knockout, drag-out series. Now, I'm sure they would take it any way they could get it, but just for the theatrics behind this NBA postseason, let's face it, this postseason hasn't blown anybody away, in my opinion.
No, it really hasn't. The best series was probably this that Boston-Milwaukee series.
Yeah. Yep.
But honestly, Steve Kerr was offered a question yesterday by someone regarding, is this like a David and Goliath or more of a David and David? And Steve Kerr responded saying basically like, I don't work for TNT anymore. I don't think about storylines or theatrics. I just want to win and play good basketball. So honestly, Charlie, I don't think they want a long seven game series for theatrics. If they can sweep this team at four, that is exactly what they'll try to do.
That's Jason Dumas, K-Ron Sports. You can read him on Bleacher Report. Anything Warriors, please. Whatever questions you have this series, I know the Hoosier State, we don't have a dog in the fight, but this will be a very entertaining matchup. Please follow him on Twitter to get your answers. JD, thanks for taking the time on a very busy day, and we'll be watching you in the midst of the madness at the Chase Center, all right?
Appreciate you, man. Thanks for having me on.
Hey, love the insight there. Again, what's Dre like behind the scenes? Steph Curry soaking it all in now at 34, coming back from two seasons where it looked like the Warriors were done, and now to be four wins away from putting themselves in very rare air. Remember, this is six times in 8 years they've marched back to the finals, and minus the KD chapter, which I know pushed people the wrong way just with superstars teaming up to try to ring chase, I think the Warriors have been as lovable of a dynasty as we've seen since MJ's Bulls. And I know they weren't very lovable around here, but in terms of just guys that have meshed and have gotten along and have stuck together, that means something. I think we're all can give a thumbs up to that. We're for teams that are built and stay together and put themselves up against everybody else as opposed to shuffling around James Harden style and hopping on six different teams in a matter of 6 years. Charlie Clifford in for the coach. Mark Carman joins us at the bottom of the hour. We're going to get Carm's thoughts from Chi-Town on the Cubbies. Matt Eberflus taking over the Bears. What's the early impression for Flus being a first-time head coach? And also a lengthy drought in Chi-Town that you may not be aware of. Plus, a little bit later, KB joins us. Who is impressing at Colts OTAs? And what in the world has the Indy 500 champ been up to since he chugged the milk in Victory Circle? Marcus Erickson's on the show before we wrap it up. We'll see you back here in two on 107.5 The Fan.
Hi guys, it's Andrew with Pine Grove Medical Clinic. Is erectile dysfunction damaging your relationship? Are you sick of the pill and all the side effects? Well, welcome to the future. We have a major medical breakthrough. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most advanced form of wave therapy. Backed by 60 clinical studies, our technology uses pressure waves to repair and open up blood vessels. We've helped countless men get rid of their ED. But what is the true end result? Their relationship, even their lives, improved drastically. If you're ready to regain your love life, call us right now, and not only will the assessment and ultrasound be free, we'll also give you a gift that produces immediate results in the bedroom. It almost never fails. This is worth $550, and it's free to callers right now. 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and experience what I call the happiness ripple effect. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now. 317-552-1111.
Celebrate Sullivan Hardware and Garden's 68th anniversary this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday with store-wide savings. Hey, Pat Sullivan here. What began with nuts and bolts has grown to include garden centers, patio furniture, grills, Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan and Fishers, which we'll also be celebrating. Wouldn't you just love a big green egg? During our 68th anniversary, we'll include, yeah, you guessed it, $68 in accessories free. Check out the specials on our patio furniture, like all-weather wicker, Berlin Gardens poly, cast aluminum, teak, and more. We specialize in excellent quality mid-price patio furniture, all sale priced at 30% off. Pick up your anniversary balloon at the register as everyone wins with savings from 10 to, yes, 68% off all gift and garden merchandise. Shop, play, experience. Spring with Sullivan's. 71st and Keystone, 49th and Penn, Cicero, and Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan in Fishers.
Hey, it's JMV for Lance and his local team at LD Smith Plumbing, 317-284-9526 online. That's ldsmithplumbing.com. The best in plumbing with this deal for you. If you're having a problem with the main drain and sewage backing up in your house, LD Smith Plumbing will come out and clear it, or it's free. That's L.D. Smith Plumbing, the number 317-284-9526. They'll clear it or it's free. With L.D. Smith Plumbing, more information online, ldsmithplumbing.com. Sunny
day. You'll be on cloud nine this summer with a spectacular offer from Diamonds Direct. Right now, for a limited time, you can make any purchase and take advantage of 0% interest financing for 5 years. It's our most popular offer ever. How about that $6,000 designer ring for just $100 a month? Fine jewelry has never been more affordable. But hurry, this is a limited time offer. 5 years, zero interest on anything and everything. Only at Diamonds Direct. Details and more at DiamondsDirect.com. On approved credit.
Whether you are a high handicapper or regularly break par, having properly fit golf clubs is vital. For a premium custom fitting that will lower your scores, see the experts at Golf Performance Academy, located at Golf Club of Indiana. They offer many top brands, including Titleist, TaylorMade, Callaway, Payne, Cobra, and Mizuno. And they are the home for Titleist Thursdays and the new hub for PXG fittings in the Indy area. For more information, go to golfindiana.com or call 317-769-6388.
Wendy's Biggie Bag is just $5. Get your choice of a double stack, junior bacon cheeseburger, or crispy chicken BLT, plus four-piece nugs, small fries, and a small drink, all for $5. U.S. price and participation may vary.
It's a night in the Fan Cave, presented by Forum. Join Kevin Bowen, Jake Query, Dan Dakich, and JMB for a night of entertainment. Find tickets and details at 1075thefan.com.
After 2 long years in the dark, it was good to finally step back into the bright Indiana sunshine.
Drivers, start your engine!
To watch the winner kiss the yard of bricks.
Indianapolis 500 roars into turn number one.
Jimmy Johnson plowed into the wall.
Oh, they're going to throw a red flag.
Marcus Ericsson, twin checkers. He has achieved racing immortality.
Congratulations.
Marcus Ericsson is a champion at Indy.
From 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan. It's the Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Eddie Garrison, that was perfect. It feels like stepbrothers up here today. You sweet child of mine, you. Garrison bailed me out. I almost got stuck in the elevator coming in to attempt to host this show today. This is Charlie Clifford of Wish TV. It's a pleasure to be back on the airwaves of 107.5. In 93.5, KB and Query have been killing it in the mornings. The coach obviously doing his thing. He's out enjoying some family time this afternoon. Your weekend starts now, everybody. Forget tomorrow. You just got to show up, okay? The 500, we did it to the nth power, nth degree, I should say. It was a beautiful Sunday. Could not have gone better.
Marcus Ericsson is coming on the show here in an hour. He has talked to more human beings than anyone, I think, in the sporting world the past 5 days. You win the 500, guess what? You have no life for the next week, and everything about it is beautiful. Who's Marcus Ericsson? So many people have texted me that, you know, we're lucky. We get an inside look at the IndyCar paddock, especially in May when they're the most just forthcoming professional athletes you'll meet, about giving you time. We need to get into who Marcus Ericsson actually is. How did he get here? What was it like as a kid? You know, and how will he now carry himself as a 500 champ? That's at 2:30. KB's joining us at 2. We need our afternoon Colts update. Mini camps around the corner. And summer break is also creeping up for the Colts, who isn't on the field for OTAs this week. That's kind of been the big question mark and dominating most of the chatter here this week. And coming up in a few minutes, Mark Carmen out of Chicago, fan-sided, WGN Radio, NBC Sports Chicago. I always equate Carm to Jerry Seinfeld. Very similar sense of humor, Eddie. Very dry, self-deprecating. He can make fun of himself. And he's been through the ringer this week. I'm not going to spoil what he's gone through. But most interested from Carm in terms of what he'll give us is, how's Matt Eberflus handling one of the biggest jobs in the NFL? That was certainly a surprise for some that the Colts defensive coordinator landed a head coaching job as big as the Bears. I love Flus as a guy. Could not be a cooler, more low-key, down-to-earth person. And it's a great story. Growing up in Toledo, blue-collar, worked his butt off to just rise through the coaching ranks in the NFL. And always appreciated what he gave us here locally. He's locked in. Matt Eberflus is locked in on winning. He is not one for conjecture, for chatter, but it sounds like he may have dropped his first little cliche, which Carm called him out on Twitter. We're going to get to that in a moment. We began the show by sounding the alarm bell on the IU hype train. Choo-choo! Here we come. Jon Rothstein calling IU the best team in the Big Ten, the Big Ten regular season title favorites this preseason. He said that late last night, and we really broke down just how much has changed in the conference and why that isn't completely preposterous for a team that hasn't been ranked inside the top 20 since Tom Crean was coaching in December of 2016. Trace Jackson Davis and the returning Hoosiers want to have something to say about that. And I asked you kind of at the beginning of the show, what is the bar for IU? We'd appreciate your thoughts as we march onward here. Ed, you just let me know when Carm's ready. But until then, I got a little intel on Purdue's situation, because that was the other surprise from Rothstein's college basketball rankings, which came out today. This is pre-preseason rankings, but now we know where the stars of last year are going, whether that's the NBA transferring or coming back to school. And in Purdue's case, they could have been helped greatly by a former Circle City prep star, Nigel Pack of Lawrence Central, who was in the transfer portal. He was one of the most sought after transfers, and he ends up going to Miami and landing a reported NIL deal worth $800,000. You were not aware of that. Nigel Pack is one of the first college athletes to truly cash in using leverage of the transfer portal on a new deal. Now, the legality of that deal is he went to Miami first and signed the deal second, but certainly Miami has put itself in the forefront of gathering alumni funds to show their athletes that, hey, if you play well here, you can make money. And more than a lot of other places, as so many schools scramble to figure out how to do this in the wild, wild west of college football and basketball that currently is sweeping the country. So Nigel Pack was interested in going to Purdue. He took a visit, and Purdue needed a point guard, knowing Jaden Ivey, their primary ball handler late in games, was going to the NBA. Eric Hunter Jr. came a little closer to home. He's going to play at Butler this season. And there's a void there for the Boilers, but apparently not enough concern for Rothstein to leave them out of his top 20 because he has Matt Painter's club as the 19th best team in America next year. Again, IU 13th if you're just joining us. So I think we can all give two thumbs up to two of the powerhouses in terms of fan bases in the Big Ten and clearly in our sacred hoop state. We would love to see more matchups where these guys are ranked against ranked, and there truly is a war on the court between top talent. So we'll continue to monitor that. The question for Purdue fans right now as you're driving, I know, is, well, what's the deal at point guard? Because Braden Smith from Westfield, can he make that jump very quickly and start as a freshman? That certainly isn't Painter's MO. We'll see. We're going to sideline the college basketball chat for now. Joining us from Fanside at WGN Radio, the Windy City Pod, it is Mark Carman. He is off the IL, and he is back, folks. Carm, bring us into your world this week. How bad was it?
Oh, wow. We're starting with my colonoscopy, huh, Charlie? Let me tell you, I'm sure I'm speaking, preaching to the choir for anyone who's ever gone through it, the prep. is one of the toughest nights you can have when you dial it in and fully commit to drinking the 3 to 4 liters of nasty fluid that's going to flow through you. That's a big moment in life. But when you get to the back end, no pun intended, you feel great. And then when you get the good results, you're happy you went through it. So thank you for bringing that up. I feel great. And we can revisit this topic in 5 years when I got to do it again.
Deal. I appreciate the live tweeting as you were marching through the treachery. I assume that before this process, Carm, you know, if someone asked you on the street, hey, Carm, how much is 3 or 4 liters? You probably wouldn't have been able to give an answer. Is it fair to say you know exactly how much 3 or 4 liters now is?
You know, it's funny because they give you this huge bottle, right? And like, you know, like drink down to 1 liter, to the 1 liter line. And I kept on looking at that bottle, trying to find the 1 liter line for hours. Like, there is no line on here that says 1 liter. Have I done enough here or not? Because you have the morning, the final 4 glasses or so it was. So yes, I have a very good idea, an exact idea. But you just made me think, like, where is the 1 liter line? You guys are making this harder than it needs to be, and it's already hard.
No, well, way to sprint through the finish, and I appreciate you hopping on. Always love to hear from you. It's like, you know, catching up. We can catch up here. I haven't seen you in 5 years, but I'm most curious about your new head football coach, our former defensive coordinator here in Indianapolis. I saw you noted that Justin Fields was rewarding Matt Eberflus with some pristine dimes on his birthday. What's the early pulse on Eberflus in Chi-Town, Carm?
So it'd be hard for him to not have people thinking positive after the Matt Nagy experience because,
sure,
you know, for someone who took the Bears to the playoffs and was 500 in 2 other seasons and had 1 season under, he left town as bad as you could possibly leave town, which is kind of amazing. It's not like the Bears, you know, have been, you know, winning Super Bowls here. Everybody still talks about 1985, right? But That whole regime, they wanted him out so bad. So here comes the Flus, and Ryan Poles, their new general manager from Kansas City, and their relationship. So it's been positive. But I kind of have my antenna up because the Bears never get anything right. And that's just the truth. And so you did hire a first-time general manager who's hiring a first-time head coach, who hired a first-time offensive coordinator, who's dealing with a quarterback who's got a lot of talent, but had a bad rookie season. Bears fans don't want to hear that at all. They want it all blamed on Nagy and the supporting cast around him. And there's definitely truth in that. But if he was – and there's a zillion quarterbacks who struggled right when they came in the league. That's all true, too. But, you know, the rules have changed, and it is more favorable for quarterbacks. And – I'm not saying that the Bears got it wrong and New England got it right with Mac Jones, but Mac Jones had a better year, and it was a way, way, way better year. And yes, I get it. He had much more. He's being coached by Bill Belichick and company, and Fields was in the situation he was in. So all that's fair. And it's just a lot, right? Like, is this whole thing going to come together and be successful? And Flus also came in with his hits principle, Charlie. Like, you know, I should have written this down before our thing.
Oh, you'll have it memorized in no time. I was trying to explain to a couple Bear fans. He is not rah-rah. You know, I don't know how much he enjoys the whole media spiel because there's no off button with Flus. I mean, he is down to the details. Even when he's talking to us, he doesn't like to water things down. He is just your X's and O's guy. There is, you know, the whole notoriety that will come with being the head coach of the Bears. Sure, if you win, it's fantastic, but I don't think that's the main reason he wanted to become a head coach.
Okay, so I actually should be interviewing you right now for Bears fans, and sure. I'm wondering if you think they made a good hire?
You know, I think the jury's out. I don't know. Just with Justin Fields, I was expecting it to be an offensive-minded guy. But in order to simplify things and to limit, you know, your variables, hey, a kick-butt defense that can take the ball away at, you know, one of the top two or three rates in the NFL, which Flus proved here, that was the top notch on his resume, is the Colts went from a defense that couldn't find turnovers if they fell in their lap to they were up there in the top three the past 2 years. So, look, I'm biased. I like the guy. I think he will win over the defensive side of the locker room. But as you said, first-time offensive coordinator, that hire is just as important as the head coach hire. And that's there's just no way around that.
Yeah. Well, to be continued, perhaps on the Windy City podcast. But listen,
yes,
the Bears have one good cornerback that's got any level of pedigree, and that's Jalen Johnson. Matt Eberflus, in the middle of OTAs, put him on the second unit because he didn't give a reason that they're moving things around and trying to see who fits with what. Well, you could leave him on the first string and put different guys with him, but it seems to me that he's trying to make a point that this is you're not going to go about your business the same way that you went about your business before, and if you want to be our top cornerback, I need better from you. But to me, it just raised some red flags like, hey, man, we had a guy in this town who coached the Chicago Bulls and was a really, like, try-hard guy in Jim Boylan, and he was an absolute disaster, and he banged on Zach LaVine on his defense and all this stuff. It's like you're kicking on Zach LaVine, who's the best player on the team, and I'm like, Eberflus, Jalen Johnson's not your problem here.
Yeah, it's an old-school approach there.
Yeah, so I'm not saying that this is, a huge deal, but I noticed it. Let's put it that way. It seemed a little bit off to me. And so you got to connect with these guys. I mean, I personally am a believer that you don't treat everybody the same in professional sports. The number one cornerback has a little more leeway than the dude who's trying to make the team. That's just how it is. Throwing the salaries too, but that doesn't seem to be the Eberflus way, and I do wonder how this will play out long term.
Look, the one thing he will have to maneuver there, the one luxury he had in Indianapolis, remember, he came over as the Cowboys defensive coordinator. He originally signed up here to work for Josh McDaniels, and that didn't happen, and Frank Reich kept him on board, and that turned out to be a great partnership. Two personalities that certainly meshed. I mean, his hardest workers on the Colts defense were also his best players. Darius Leonard, DeForest Buckner, two all pros. He never had to deal with the star player that you were curious, oh gosh, is that guy really giving Eberflus 100%? I don't think he ever ran into that problem here, which it sounds like in the early going in Chicago. I mean, at some point you're going to run into a talented player that you're right. You're going to have to find that right button to push as the head coach and hopefully get the Bears back. You mentioned Poles, the new general manager. To put into perspective for folks in Indy, Ryan Poles was a college teammate of Matt Ryan at BC. That's a little bizarre, Carm.
Yeah, and there's all these weird connections now, and John Fox coming back.
Yeah.
You know,
Give me something on Foxy Cleopatra, because that we haven't talked about that yet.
Well, Foxy Cleopatra, I've never heard him called that, but I like it. He sucked when he was here, Charlie. He was, you know, burnt out, Carolina to Denver to Chicago to I think he was just whatever was going on off the field was not helping him completely be dialed in as the head coach of the Chicago Bears.
That's fair.
And he was, I mean, you know, Bears fans right now, who do they hate more, Matt Nagy or John Fox? They might, with a recency bias, say Nagy, but those two, it's not even close. John Fox was an absolute disaster here. Listen, he's got an enormous pedigree, and
yes,
and can he be a valued defensive, whatever the title is that they gave him, to, you know, have some level of impact on the Colt defense? I don't think there's any reason why he can't do that. But I also, like, John, you're late, and go coach a high school team if you're bored in Florida and have nothing to do. But you know, everybody's got friends in the league, and apparently him and Frank Reich just felt it was the right time to reconnect and do the thing. So
interesting.
There you go.
Interesting. Hey, let's segue. We just talked about game one of the finals and Pacers and Bulls. Let's face it. There's a mountain to climb here, and there's a couple ways to do it. It feels like the Bulls are where the Pacers were a few years ago with Victor Oladipo, some nice pieces to build around, you know, first round potential, you know, potential to steal a series to get into that second round. But the ceiling would make you depressed because you knew this team could not ascend to be a legit threat to win an Eastern Conference championship. Now the Pacers have decided to break down the walls and to go, you know, back to the cement mixer here and really smooth things out at the bottom floor and hope you can hit on a couple drafts. Where are Bulls fans at? Is that an accurate read? Are you bullish on this core ultimately doing something? And do you like that comparison to the Pacer team a few years ago here?
I love that comparison to the Pacers team, but I would actually say that Pacers team, to me, I mean, Victor Oladipo against the Miami Heat was out of his skull. I thought that you guys were on a great path at that point. I don't have the same feeling on where the Bulls are at. The Bulls are, I mean, DeMar DeRozan was incredible, but DeMar DeRozan is getting to his mid-30s, and it's hard to believe that he could ever have the season that he had last year. Zach LaVine is on his second knee surgery. Granted, it's just a scope, but it's the same knee where he tore his ACL. And you are basically have no choice other than to give him a max deal, which is going to limit your ability to bring in anyone else. Vucevic is on the final year of his deal, so he's got no value in a trade. And, you know, you're not exactly ready to win a championship this year. So, you know, what's the great season for the Bulls? Win a playoff series?
Right.
You know, be a 4-seed, 5-seed, win a playoff series and go out? I mean, I think that's about what it is. Unless, you know, Patrick Williams, their number one draft pick from last year, who was hurt all the season and had a couple moments in the playoffs, unless he turns into, you know, people have thrown out ridiculous comps like he's going to be Kawhi Leonard. I'm like, that's not who he is at all.
That's a reasonable place to start.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, well, Kawhi was a defensive guy first, and then look what he turned into. I'm like, you know, there's one of him, and Patrick Williams is not going to be 1A, I'm sorry, or 1B. I like Patrick Williams, but I don't, you know, so it's a fine selection, yada, yada. But, and then you got the 18th pick in the draft, and you've got veteran minimums. Who are you bringing in here, or are you being super creative with a sign-and-trade deal with Zach? And, you know, are you actually going to get Zach LaVine-level value back? I mean, it's
tough.
The Bulls feel to me, yeah, it's real tough, right? So, like, what are you? To me, you reek of an NBA team who's trying to be competitive and just make money for the owner who wants to win championships on the baseball field a lot more than he does on the basketball field, because he said himself, he traded all six titles for another White Sox ring, which is just unfortunate that anybody would say such a thing.
Carm, you know it stinks more than that. This time last summer, we were all entranced in the six-parter, MJ and the Bulls,
waltzing through through Indy and all the great stories that came from that. It just stinks that we're so far off that path for two cities that would love nothing more than to see that rivalry really heat up again. It's just so dormant right now. I was at multiple Bulls Pacer games this year. There were a lot of Bulls fans in the house. It's just a beautiful thing when that's cooking, and I know you have much more to say about that than I do because I was too young to catch, you know, that as an adult.
So you are taking me back to driving down there like 1999.
Come on, put me in the car with Carm. What's on the radio? Who's the love interest in your life? You know, what are you getting done before you have to go to the bar after you file your post-game interviews?
Yeah, well, this I'm going strict fan, 92, still in college, University of Iowa, first girlfriend, Katie, who now lives out in Portland.
Still know where she lives?
Uh-oh. Oh, yeah, she's still friends coming into town. We're going to
love
see
it.
Her and the kid coming in, great person.
Love it.
All that. So, you know, I remember being in Market Square, and we were yelling for Cliff Levingston, who was a bull off the bench who wore 53, and they would call him Goo. And so I remember screaming goo from that. Like, there was that circle that you could walk around at Old Market Square. I know Pacer fans know what I'm talking about right now. And honestly, from the last dance, I'm like, how the hell did I not drive down there for his comeback game where tickets were going for like $125 a seat, which is feels like nothing, right? You could have paid
$1,000.
It should have been, $1,000. It's $125 I could have gotten in. And seen Jordan's 8-for-28 and lost to Reggie. I mean, I'd kill to go back and do that. You know, how was I not there? I mean, I drove up to Detroit for Jordan's first preseason game when he returned with the Wizards.
Oh my God!
Why didn't I drive to Market Square? It's a terrible job. But yeah, the rivalry. I mean, I was in '98. I was at all those games. That was the first time when I was actually covering. And
wow.
Larry Bird was so incredibly cool. That was a, you know, huge highlight for, you know, a young Carm. You grow up, you're watching Bird and Magic, and then, you know, of course, Mike, and then
dreams.
Yeah, it was incredible. It really was. And Larry was awesome, man. He was playing 10 guys at the time. And I remember asking him, like, why do you play, you know, you play all these guys. Well, everybody wants to be a part of a team. I'm like, you're right, Larry. Everybody does want to be a part of a team. I want to be a part of a team. Can we be friends?
Don't outthink your park district coach growing up. Everyone's play, you know, five in, five out. That's cool. That's a cool note.
Yep. That's what they were doing. And people didn't, you know, nobody thought that Bird was going to be a successful coach at the time. At least I didn't. And then he was. So.
Yeah,
you're right, man. Charlie, I'd love to see that rivalry come back. But, you know, Jordan and Miller, that was real stuff. They hated each other.
I know. It was fun to relive it and fun to catch up here, Carm. Hey, this is Mark Carmen. Catch him on Twitter, fan-sided, digital host, the Windy City Pod. Please, any Bulls fans, Bears fans that are passing through town, he is your guy. And most importantly, happy you're back on your feet and you're mobile there, partner.
Charlie, you're the man. Keep killing it, brother. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. That's Mark Carmen. Guys, again, WGN Radio, one of the funniest people you will meet in the Chicago media landscape, and appreciate him going through the glory days of covering Pacers Bulls and also letting us know how Matt Eberflus is doing in Chicago. We certainly have plenty of interest to see how Flus does, and I think it's safe to say we're all wishing he does well. He's in the NFC. He has to try to figure out a way to beat Aaron Rodgers for the first time in a century in Chicago. And certainly he has a young quarterback with some promise in Justin Fields. So, Edward, are we taking a little time out here? That's the plan. Kevin Bowen at 2. We are going to get more answers on the early impressions of Matt Ryan. Many of you are wondering, is this going to be Philip Rivers 2.0? Is this going to be someone who will be banking on an offensive line to be top notch in the pass protection department? Where did the Colts rank in pass protection last year? You will not want to hear that answer. Plus, which name is emerging potentially in the wide receiver room and who is not at the Colts complex, who may be there later this year trying to catch passes from Matt Ryan? All those debates are on the way with KB at the top of the hour. This is Charlie Clifford in for the coach. We'll be back in two.
Michaelis is the calm after the storm. More than three decades of restoring damage from wind, rain, and hail. They've got your back, not to mention your front, side, and roof. From site security and tarping services to complete restoration work, they can handle anything Mother Nature throws your way. Water, storms, fire, and foundations. Life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. Call 844-FIX-INDY. Make it Michaelis.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in realty. Mark Deedle Realty. 317-755-4232. That's 317-755-4232. Online, markdeedle.com. That's Mark DIETEL.com today. So let's talk about Chris from Noblesville. They were ready to upgrade to a newly built home. They hired Mark Deedle and asked him to maximize the current home price so they could afford their new home. Mark gave them a plan to get the most money possible, and he pushed the price hard to get them $15,000 over a high asking price and plenty of time to get into their new home. Mark Deedle has a guarantee for you. Multiple offers on your home in 3 days, or he is going to list it for free. That's Mark Deedle Realty, 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232, markdeedle.com. That's Mark DIETEL.com today.
I met my wife at the Indy 500. We've been going to the race together ever since. But this year, I don't know if she'd even be alive. My wife was one of the 1,000 Hoosiers on the waiting list for a life-saving organ transplant. Thanks to someone just like you, who said yes to being an organ donor, my wife received a life-saving transplant, and we're going to the Indy 500 this year. You can do something legendary to save lives. Learn more at DrivenToSaveLives.org.
We're the most active season of the year right now, but if you have joint pain, you can't live like you want to. Whether it's, you know, heading to the zoo, walking on the canal, attending an Indians game, hip pain, knee pain, back pain, shoulder pain, it sucks the fun out of living. I'm Kevin Bowen, and I've got some fantastic news for you, though. QC Kinetics is helping the people get the fun back with advanced regenerative treatments from local professionals right here in Indy, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. We're talking regenerative medicine. It's the hottest thing going. It's basically a growth factors with healing properties from your own body, highly concentrated, then putting them into your aching joints. It's exciting. In-office, non-surgical treatment can repair and restore damaged tissue in your joints, giving you real, lasting relief from pain. QC Kinetics is the nation's leader in these cutting-edge, all-natural options, and the patient satisfaction reports are incredible. Yes, you can get real relief from pain with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. So call QC Kinetics 463-235-7160. Again, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood.
Summer. Birds, bees, and yep, air conditioners. So cool down, save big. Call 888-RHINO-41. Don't paint, don't vinyl. Go Rhino. Rhino Shield.
Your home for the 2022 NBA playoffs and the NBA finals. 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's the Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
This is Charlie Clifford of Wish TV with Eddie Garrison. Eddie, I'm already losing important pieces of documentation here. Got stuck in the elevator on the way in. Got a parking ticket this morning, and now apparently just lost my parking ticket for your fine folks at Emmis. So we're going to deal with the parking situation later. Things are looking up from here. I'm going to continue to beat this drum that this is the weekend for you. Your summer's in front of you. You just did the Indy 500 proper for the first time in 3 years. Probably getting your sea legs back for the first time since before you engulfed on the West Side and all of its shenanigans this past weekend. So before you have to go to 7 weddings, the 3 family trips that you still got to make, all the other little agenda items of the summer that maybe you aren't overly thrilled about, but you know, attendance is everything in life. It's about showing up. You need to be there. I'm not giving you a hall pass there. This weekend, however, is for you. And it's for you to get back downtown and enjoy what's one of the best cities anywhere in terms of eating, drinking, and catching up with friends that maybe we haven't seen through the winter and through the last 2 years of what have been a blur. So carve this one out for you, okay? Before summer gets away from you, it's June, it's 77 and sunny. You can start tonight. Don't worry, you just need to set an alarm tomorrow and get there. Please, take one for you, and this weekend is on us. Charlie Clifford and Eddie Garrison, finals game one. You heard from Jason Dumas out on the West Coast. Warriors, Steve Kerr, 21-2 in game ones. Boston, however, 11-5-1 against the spread. So maybe you're picking the Warriors, but you're picking the Celts to cover tonight. It's, yes, Warriors favored by 3.5, 4.5, depending on where you get it. Alexander Rossi, we mentioned this earlier, the IndyCar note so far of the day. He's going to Arrow McLaren SP. Of course, the Memorial Golf back at Dublin, Ohio. Round one is underway if you're keeping an eye on the puck. Western Conference Final Game two, Oilers and Avs, 8 o'clock tonight. We have Kevin Bowen just a couple minutes away. Chris Presley was in here earlier, podcast aficionado. He is the one with KB on Kevin's Corner Pod. They do a great job of giving you the finer notes of what's happening behind the scenes with the Colts. We'll get Kevin's thoughts on the emerging wide receiver room. Who wants to catch the football and make themselves some money? There is money to be made for players that are just trying to find their footing in the NFL and do it with Matt Ryan, who historically has been one of the toughest and more accurate quarterbacks we've seen. And now you get to see him up close and personal for the first time. I know Grand Park, you're going to be there this summer in Westfield. Plenty of good juju around the Colts, and that's just saying it how it is. Of course, you have questions about the ceiling of this team. Well, we know who's running the football, and now we see how these other pieces are going to fall into place with a new defensive coordinator, some new talent on the edge, and still questions to be had at wide receiver. So KB, just about 3 minutes away here on 107.5 The Fan. Charlie Clifford of Wish TV in for the coach today. Our final hour to get you to your weekend. Yes, it starts on Thursday. We're giving you the bonus day. We'll be back in two.
Well, another 500 is in the books. So let's look at the June checklist. Colts draft, check. Pacers didn't make the playoffs, check. The race is over? Check. Now back to the speculation, conjecture, and rumors.
I hear Shaedon Sharpe. I've never seen the guy other than YouTube clips.
With the sixth pick, the Indiana Pacers select.
Find out June 23rd with the NBA Draft on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Sunny day.
You'll be on cloud nine this summer with a spectacular offer from Diamonds Direct. Right now, for a limited time, you can make any purchase and take advantage of 0% interest financing for 5 years. It's our most popular offer ever. How about that $6,000 designer ring for just $100 a month? Fine jewelry has never been more affordable. But hurry, this is a limited time offer. 5 years, zero interest on anything and everything. Only at Diamonds Direct. Details and more at DiamondsDirect.com. On approved credit.
This.
Start your engine!
May. And the race to renew is on. Indy 500 ticket renewals are open for the next 500 hours.
They're swerving back and forth!
Come back home again next May with 300,000 of your closest friends.
They jump to their feet and they start pumping those fists.
Lock in your seats by June 20th for the lowest prices available.
And be the first in line for upgrades.
Marcus Ericsson is too strong!
Details at IMS.com.
This
Marcus Ericsson has achieved racing immortality.
Is May.
Yeah, that's right. I bet you didn't expect to see me here. Well, here I am. Let me tell you about a little something called respect. You ever heard of it? You know what? I think it's not...
You're good at using your time in the shower to replay conversations and say what you should have said. We're good at your insurance. Find an Indiana Farm Bureau insurance agent online, over the phone, or in person, and stop knocking on wood.
Just, I think you, it's time for you to get out. You should just leave.
Bowling, 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 keep them balls a-rolling. Bowling, 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 Royal Pin.
Are you-
you looking to stay cool this summer and have fun with your family and friends? Call Royal Pin Entertainment at 465-8484 to join a summer league today. Summer leagues are fun and affordable and last only a short time. If you're going to bowl this summer, bowl at a Royal Pin Entertainment Center. Call 465-8484 or go to royalpin.com to join a league today. Grab your friends and stop in your favorite Royal Pin Entertainment Center for open play. Reserve your lanes by the hour at royalpin.com. Come bowling this summer and have the time of your life. Call 465-8484 or go to royalpin.com.
Royal Pin Bowling, bowling.
The Indy 1500 Gun and Knife Show is this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the Indiana State Fairgrounds for sporting, hunting, and personal protection. Visit the Indy 1500 Gun Show.
Let's go to Vegas, Colts fans, with BullseyeEventGroup.com. Private air charter and a direct flight with a two-night weekend travel package at Caesars Palace. It's Vegas, baby. Get your spot now. BullseyeEventGroup.com.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W298BB. WIBC HD3 W228CX. Indianapolis.
Friday on Kevin Aquari, we are recapping game one of the NBA Finals and setting you up for the first weekend in June. Come join us 7 a.m. right here on The Fan.
It's The Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5.
Eddie Garrison is picking up the heat, ladies and gentlemen. Hold on to your butts. Let's go. A familiar voice. You've made him a part of your morning routine. One of the best morning shows you'll catch anywhere. Kevin in Query. Kevin Bowen is on. Kevin, fantastic chat with Mike Locksley, head coach of the Maryland Terrapins, Nick Cross's collegiate coach. I thought that was a huge tip of the cap to one of the more unique coaching journeys. He's been through a ton. Job well done this morning.
Charlie Clifford, always good to chat with you. So I'll start there and glad you're filling in today. Always good to hear your voice.
Appreciate you.
Chat. Yeah, Locksley, that was great. You know, whenever the draft happens, the draft ends and you're kind of curious, you reach out to these coaches, you want to get a little bit more insight into them. We hope to get Luke Fickell on, and then, you know, Jelani right. Woods transferred, so you don't really know how that's going to work. We got Bernard Ryman, and Cross is kind of the one that we hadn't gotten on yet, or a Cross connection. And Mark Dykton just kept on reaching out, and Locksley, the Cross stuff was just really half the conversation. Jake did a terrific job, and, you know, looking up a little bit more background on Mike Locksley, a guy that, you know, I feel like we see on the Big Ten sidelines, but we just don't know a whole lot about him, or at least I'll speak from my own viewpoint. And that was a really, really enjoyable listen. And I don't know if you caught the end of the conversation when Jake and I just chatted off air, but it just makes so much sense to me. And I get it. You and I, and I'm sorry, I'm kind of going off on a tangent here, but like, we're in the business of we benefit when access is granted. And indirectly, the Fan, obviously. And I mean fans, not just the Fan, the actual radio station. Fans benefit when we have that access.
Yep.
And if I were a sports information director at a college, I would be trying to pitch to my head basketball, football, whatever coach that you carve out 1 to 2 media segments every single day. We're talking 15 to 30 minutes every single day to do a radio hit in your conferences area, like Locksley did today. You know, the Indy market obviously is a hotbed.
No doubt.
His conference. And then certainly one, you know, a little bit more maybe around your alumni base, around your own community, things like that. Because when you have someone like Locksley that has the story he has, I think the more you present that, and this goes for a variety of sports, but mainly we're talking football or college basketball here, I think you show that to future recruits. You show that to alumni bases. You show that to potential NIL, you know, whatever, boosters, donors, whatever you want to call it. I just think that's so valuable. So I appreciate Maryland doing that, and I thought it was really beneficial for him.
No, yeah, to fill you in on quickly on Locksley, he had lost his son to gun violence 5 years ago, same son who battled very serious mental health struggles, and it just all came together so nicely. And what is tough, as you said, he's out of market. He doesn't know you and Jake from two random guys on the street, and not only giving a nice endorsement of Nick Cross, who could be a long-term stalwart at safety for Chris Ballard and the Colts, but also a look into his coaching journey. You listed off how many places he's coached. I mean, the guy's moved 25 times. It's insane. It's insane. And everybody won for that conversation. So I'm sure you can catch that on the archive on 107.5. KB, Matt Ryan in person, the arm strength. How do you describe the ball coming off Ryan's right hand?
You know, I'd probably start with just on time. More so than the strength, it's the accuracy. And it's not just like the ball is in a catchable location. It's the ball is in a position where oftentimes a pass catcher doesn't have to break stride. And obviously we have to reiterate, this is 7-on-7. There's no pass rush. It was June 1st yesterday when I was out there. So, preface all of that. But I just see a quarterback, Charlie, that throws guys open, sifts through his progressions in a efficient manner, and just, I think, has confidence to go with the football, or know where he's going with the football. And really, it's kind of a fine balance, because a lot of it is, again, you've got to be super knowledgeable to know where you want to go with it.
Especially with a new offense, no?
Right. Well, yeah, that's what I was getting at second. You also have to have a little bit of you-know-what, a little bit of, kind of gumption to be able to, risk throwing that ball before your new pass catchers maybe are turned around. There was a play yesterday where Nick Foles thought he had Nyheim Hines. It's kind of a little underneath the route. I believe it was Hines on a red zone rep. And Sterling Weatherford, who actually is a Cicero native, played the Miami of Ohio rookie.
Love him.
He sniffed it out, jumped it, and he's a safety making a transition to linebacker. Picked it up and ran the other way for a touchdown. Like, that is one of those plays where, Foles, I think, would admit he waited to see Hines open.
Right.
And if you wait to see guys open in this league,
it's going the other way.
Yeah, exactly. Six going the other way. So I just feel like with Ryan, that has been something that we've seen. So again, arm strength, it's not going to be on the same level as Wentz. Escaping to make plays with his legs, no. But from a precision and know where to go with the football, I think more often than not, you've certainly upgraded there.
That's a great note on Foles. Maybe this Weatherford kid's just been reading Frank Reich's press conference transcripts. Hey, we're throwing the ball to Hines a ton more this year. I'm just going to cover him, and eventually I'm going to make a play. Well done, rookie. How many things stood out? Again, they're going through drills. This is not even training camp intensity. I just remember early with Rivers, granted, we had missed the offseason program. We were kind of jumping in and seeing him for the first time. I believe it was at camp, which was at the Colts complex that year. I will never forget Rivers in between plays, running to the sideline, grabbing an iPad, and just the guy was an energizer bunny. There was not a wasted second when watching Philip Rivers practice. Anything you can take away from little details about just Matt Ryan out on the practice field outside of when he's working, KB?
Yeah, I don't know if it's maybe as is theatrical the right word to describe.
Yeah, maybe meticulous. Like there's always something on Philip's mind. There's always something to be sharpened. Maybe at least that's how I took it.
Yeah, I think Ryan might have just a tad more of a laid-back nature. Like, the Rivers mannerisms, how Philip Rivers talks, all of that, I think, kind of became a folk hero, frankly. It was like, before 60 Minutes starts on CBS every Sunday at 7 o'clock, we've got a two-minute drill, and here comes Philip Rivers trying to lead the Chargers back down four. Like, it almost became like an American ritual for us to watch Philip Rivers.
That's a great way to say it.
Basis. At that time, I don't think Rivers is that, but again, when you listen to a guy like Reggie Wayne shake his head and be like, I can't believe it. I feel like, it's Peyton Manning back in the building. More, I think, from, a detail-oriented, his intellect. And I just think playing quarterback in the NFL, you make an absurd amount of money. We all know that. You also have to be kind of a master at realizing that You are the quarterback, so there's tons of responsibility that comes with that. There's tons of obligations that come with that.
Mm-hmm.
But then also, can you be a normal dude? Like, can you be one of 53? Can, you know, there's, you know, whatever, there'll be 53 Colts on the roster come September 1st, and what, a dozen of them will be undrafted free agents at some point in their careers? You know, like, can you relate to those guys and not relate to just the, you know, just the quarterbacks or just the guys that are making a ton of money? And it just seems like Ryan strikes you as a dude. And Charlie, you and I would love him because he's a big, big golfer.
But yeah, right.
He's a guy that
Travis Matthews, like, he's on the payroll, isn't he?
Yeah, I was going to say, he certainly rocks a lot of that.
Yeah.
Just a guy that you want to have a couple beers with and go play golf. And, again, I don't think there was, like, a maliciousness with Carson Wentz, but there just wasn't, I think, a connection within the Colts locker room. And I think a bit of it was unfair to Carson in that the Philadelphia exit, right or wrong, brought about a whole lot of whispers. Mm-hmm. And a whole lot of, man, you know, it didn't go well. The Jalen Hurts draft pick, like, you know, the locker room didn't love him, this and that. And I just think it's human instinct to, when adversity hit the Colts last year, that stuff started to kind of boil up again. We don't have that with Matt Ryan. I mean, he left Atlanta on great terms. They never really drafted that young QB to pass the torch to. And sure, they had interest in Deshaun Watson, like a lot of teams, I think, had interest in Deshaun Watson, and that's what led him here. But it just seems like there's a little bit more of, guys, that's Matt Ryan. That's a lot of respect. Whereas with Carson Wentz, it was, you kind of got to go out there and earn it.
I think that's fair, and I appreciate your insight there because you just have such a unique viewpoint. And you know, look, dealing with Carson Wentz this past year, he was on with AC every Wednesday. You know, that guy's a fantastic human being. And I really wish Colts fans would have gotten a chance to see him, you know, a normal season where he could have been out and about in the community. I know he did a bunch to begin with. So I'll never be one that believes that, oh gosh, there's just, you know, his whole personality there was going to be a problem there. I, you know, I wish him nothing but the best in DC, but that is a great just differentiator with Ryan. Look, he's proven it both in the locker room and on the field, and ultimately that's going to be a beautiful thing for Frank Reich as we try to figure out who are going to catch these passes besides Michael Pittman Jr. Kev, I read your blog, the latest from OTAs. I love the question you posed of, like, who's going to catch the second most passes next year? Completely, the odds are all over the board. Give me the latest on the receiving core, because for me, that is the topic that there's just so many unanswered questions. This, for being June 2nd, I mean, we're still, it's time to figure it out. Who is there going to be a signing coming in? Or are you going to ride with who you have? Give me the latest on that topic.
And, you know, the other, I think, interesting angle to it, Charlie, is we don't often have this. Like, here we are in late May and June.
No.
And yesterday, Frank Reich and Chris Ballard sat down and were like, hey, what have you seen from the wideout so far? Should we go and make a move? Like, it usually isn't that cut and dry where we have this kind of three-week evaluation for a position that largely could shape if T.Y. Hilton is brought back.
Right.
You know, are names like Julio Jones and Odell Beckham even on the radar? Like, you know, some of these other veteran wideouts, or are you going to roll with what you got and be an incredibly unproven group and be an extremely young group and hope that Matt Ryan and that bunch can come along together? So it's just unusual to be in that sort of position. My thoughts, I would sleep better at night with a veteran wideout in that room.
What other names are on that board, KB, before we move past that? Because OBJ's coming off the knee. I assume he's not going to be ready for the beginning of this season, no?
Yeah, I wouldn't think so. I mean, that was
obviously. There's no way. It's February.
In the Super Bowl. Yeah, so, you know, that wouldn't be there.
And I mean, Chris Ballard is not signing OBJ. We can both agree to that, no?
That's, you know, probably accurate. I've probably been more of a Hilton guy than most here lately. I mean, you know, again, to continue the golf analogy, I don't think he's walking up 18. I don't act like he's on the first hole, but, you know, if he's on hole 15 or 16, you know, can you get a couple more holes out of him? And can he be a guy that, with improved quarterback play, that ball against the Raiders is on target. And now T.Y. Hilton has a 50, 60-yard gain.
Fair.
And maybe totally reshapes that game or that season. I mean, it is a group that you'd be kind of grasping at straws. Again, I don't have Kev, the names in front of me.
Kev, would Hilton take a reduced role to be a third down game changer? Do you think he would sign up for that at this point?
No.
Because that's the question, no? Like, hey, we would love to have you back, but you need to agree to this, you know, outline of you're going to play a significant less amount of snaps because there's younger guys that we need to get a look at.
Yeah, and again, I don't know how much less of snaps is the issue or how much of it is just less money and him handling that ego check. I mean, the guy made, what, 1 year, $10 million, right?
Yep.
That was the deal last season. Yeah, I wouldn't go out over anything over a couple million, and that's a big ego check. I still think, like, he should play. I mean, has Desmond Patman earned the right to play, you know, 80% of the snaps in a game? Has Mike Strawn earned the right? As you know, some of the yes, we would like to see them, but again, they were 6th and 7th round picks. It's odd to me, Charlie, that the Colts sit here and have gone with this approach at wideout, and it's not like they've got these first, second round picks waiting in the wings. You know, last year on the defensive line, you were thinking, all right, Kamoko Ture, second round pick. Tyquan Lewis.
Yeah, that's fair.
Ben Banigu, second round pick. Like,
yeah.
You don't have that at wideout. I mean, sure, Paris Campbell, but again, Paris Campbell at this point, I think is more of hope than realistic. You know, he can be available for 17 games. So, you know, I'm trying to get some of the names out there. I mean, a lot of these guys, Emmanuel Sanders, Cole Beasley, you know, some of them were older. I thought Jarvis Landry, who got signed by the Saints a couple weeks ago, I thought that was a name to look into. And then even back in March, a little bit more of, you know, if something happens to Pittman, you know, you just aren't in a great position at a position that I think means a lot. And I know that Chris Bauer certainly disagrees with that. I just continue to look at, you know, last year, deep January, pick any of those final four teams, pick any of those final eight.
I know,
teams.
They all got two.
You're going to see.
I love your note. Yeah, hey, you don't have one, it's two, and then a supporting cast around those two. It's tough. It's tough to convince yourself that, you know, the ceiling is going to be raised significantly, as you said, without adding talent on the outside. But hey, maybe that's happened. Maybe Alec Pierce is going to break the mold of how tough it is as rookie wide receivers to really make a significant impact, and he'll be that guy. And maybe Kylan Granson and this tight end trio with Woods and Big Mo can be, as you said, Matt Ryan's made some hay for some tight ends before that weren't necessarily you know, Austin Hooper or Tony Gonzalez. Other guys have played well under him. So interesting. Give me to Kenny Moore. I know he changed agents. I understand, you know, money's the issue. He's got what, $6.5+ million, two more years. So that's like 13 mil. How big is the gap that you think we're talking about here for him to potentially let this linger into training camp? Is that a realistic outcome that we would see Kenny hold out for a significant portion of time, KB?
Yeah, it's a great question. I don't think it's I don't think it should be a big gap. I understand where Kenny's coming from. He probably deserves more money. I don't think it's a significant amount of more money. But at the same time, Chris Bauer could look at Kenny Moore and say, Kenny, you're mad right now because you're on a 4-year contract. Well, you also fired your previous agent for a reason. So I'm sorry. Like, that agent shouldn't have signed you or offered up, you know, kind of a 4-year deal, or else you wouldn't be in the position that you feel like you're in right now, where you still have 2 years left in this deal. It's rather unheard of, Charlie, for an NFL team to rip up a contract with 2 years left on it.
Yeah.
And offer a lot more money. And I think Ballard knows that, and he knows the precedent that he'd be setting if he did do that. Now, can you make some amendments, if you will?
Sure.
Say, all right, if you play really well this year,
right,
you're going to get paid. You'll have 1 year left in your
performance
deal,
bonuses. Is that where we meet in the middle? Hey, if you throw another one of those years up, right?
Yeah.
And let's
be along those lines.
When Kenny signed that deal,
I think all of us looked at each other and said, hey, that's a pretty good deal for both sides. Like, that wasn't a, you know, he didn't take any discounts. Obviously, second year, second and first real big NFL deal.
Right.
I don't know. Where do you fall on, like, whose side would you pick looking at this as a litigator?
Yeah, again, I can see both sides to it. I think you can make strong debates for each side. I do think Kenny deserves a little bit more money, but the fact that there's 2 years left, if yeah. I'm the Colts, that'd be a big cautionary tale. And again, the financial approach the Colts have had, I've disagreed with, but this is one where I'm like, it is a bit of a slippery slope of when you get into, I mean, this would be Kenny's third NFL contract. You know, it's just not often that you see that. You know, having said that, you know, I hear all these people say, hey, what's the trade value for Kenny Moore? Let's pump the brakes a little bit there. No. I mean, as much as I think Isaiah Rodgers is coming on and can have a great year, Stephon Gilmore's 32, and Kenny Moore is not just a slot corner for you. He's an extremely reliable, consistent player. I know consistent is not the greatest compliment in the world. I think it's got a kind of a negative stereotype to it at times. I think it's a great compliment for a guy that plays a position that when you get burned, we all remember it. Yeah. But I just think Kenny is oftentimes extremely consistent. I think he sets a tone for your defense as well. The old phrase, deadlines for action. I just think if we will have something by training camp. I don't know how public it'll be, mm-hmm. but I think we will. And you know this full well, Charlie, because you've talked to Kenny. He is a guy, and it's hard to, I think, put ourselves into his shoes, but he is a guy that has felt extremely slighted throughout his football career.
Yeah, it's what's fueled this story, which is an incredible story.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think it's what's made him
no question.
The level player that he is from a work ethic standpoint of too small school in Valdosta State, too short, you're not going to get drafted. You know,
cut by the Pats.
Patriots cut him.
Yep.
You know,
yep.
Ballard wasn't a believer in him initially. You know, all of those things is why Kenny Moore, I think, has helped turn into the player that he is. So super interested to see how it's going to turn out because it's unprecedented for the Colts to kind of be in this situation based off recent times. But at the end of the day, I think what Kenny's thinking and what he wants, I don't know if Chris Ballard's going to budge.
Yeah, well, I hope it comes together because that secondary room with Mike Mitchell, who looks like he's having more fun than any assistant coach in the National Football League right now. I mean, the dude, I think every turnover, he's bringing it back to the house with the TD celebration. No? That guy's been electric.
He is. And again, Isaiah Rodgers, I know Mike's background's more.
I heard you this morning, pumping Rodgers, man. KB is buying the Isaiah Rodgers stock, Indianapolis. That's out there.
You know, it's funny when you watch, I don't know if you do this, and I know you're up against it, so I'll try not to be too long. But when a quarterback throws the ball, my eyes immediately go to where I assume that ball is going. And when I look towards the pass catcher and the defender and the ball's still in the air, whenever I see 34 in a white jersey or whatever jersey he's wearing color-wise.
It's very sound, very sound, right?
Yeah, I'm like, that dude's in great position.
Yeah.
That dude looks comfortable, which is kind of a weird word to use. That dude is not going to panic right now. And more often than not, he's going to make a winning play at the moment of truth. And he did that again yesterday several times. He did it last week as well. He's done that at times in his first two seasons. It was a big jump. UMass is a god-awful football team where he came from. They were horrific on defense, so he got thrown out a lot. But I am, again, he's the defensive guy that – you know, probably is the most under the radar that I think could take a huge jump.
Good. We got that name circled. KB, you hear him every morning. You'll get him tomorrow with Jake Query on Kevin and Query. Appreciate your time, KB, and enjoy a good excursion this weekend, all right?
Charlie, someone just DM'd me saying how much they've enjoyed listening to you today, and I know a lot of people feel that way. So glad you're in the chair, and hopefully see you soon.
Hey, man, I appreciate you. And I know KB's going to have the memorial on wherever his travels take him this weekend. We're going to take a break here. Marcus Ericsson, Indy 500 champ. What has gone on since Marcus chugged the milk in Victory Circle on the west side? A worthy winner of the Indianapolis 500 race who has a story I think we can all smile and cheers to this weekend as we continue to relive being back at our favorite place on earth. We'll be back on 107.5 The Fan. This is Charlie Clifford. We'll see you in two.
Whether you are a high handicapper or regularly break par, having properly fit golf clubs is vital. For a premium custom fitting that will lower your scores, see the experts at Golf Performance Academy, located at Golf Club of Indiana. They offer many top brands, including Titleist, TaylorMade, Callaway, Payne, Cobra, and Mizuno. And they are the home for Titleist Thursdays and the new hub for PXG fittings in the Indy area. For more information, go to golfindiana.com or call 317-769-6388.
Introducing an all-new way to save with Xfinity. It's a 3-for-1 bundle. Get unlimited internet, streaming, and Xfinity Mobile all for what you could pay wireless companies for just one 5G unlimited line. That's truly an unbelievable value. And now, also, with Xfinity Internet, you can get unlimited data, Wi-Fi equipment, and a free Flex 4K streaming box included. With a 2-year rate guarantee, no term contract, all for just $30 per month when you add an Xfinity Mobile plan at regular rates. Go to Xfinity.com/3-for-1 or call 1-800-XFINITY or visit an Xfinity store today. Limited time offer. Restrictions do apply. Requires paperless billing and auto pay. New fast internet, 300 megabytes per second, customers only. Xfinity Mobile requires post-pay Xfinity internet. And after 24 months, regular rates do apply to all services and devices.
L.D. Smith Plumbing.
A dirty, stinking honest.
Fog, drain, putting a damper on your day? Call the experts at L.D. Smith Plumbing. Not only are we water's boss, we are the masters of muck, the sleuths of the sludge. We'll sniff out the clog and snuff it out at the source. Plumbing may not be pretty, but we're pretty darn good at it. Call today to schedule your $83 drain clearing, guaranteed to work, or it's free.
L.D. Smith Plumbing.
A dirty, stinking honest.
What will put you and your love on cloud nine this June? It's Diamonds Direct's most amazing offer this year. Right now, for a limited time on any purchase, get the best price, pay nothing down, and get 5 years zero interest financing. If you've been swooning over that $5,000 designer ring, right now it's only $85 a month. $3,000 diamond studs, just $50 a month, and they're yours. Don't miss this special limited time financing event exclusively at Diamonds Direct. Get details and more at DiamondsDirect.com. On approved credit.
This is
Start Your Engine
May. And the race to renew is on. Indy 500 ticket renewals are open for the next 500 hours.
They're swerving back and forth.
Come back home again next May with 300,000 of your closest friends.
They jump to their feet and they start pumping those fists.
Lock in your seats by June 20th for the lowest prices available. And be the first in line for upgrades.
Marcus Ericsson is too strong.
Details at IMS.com. This
Marcus Ericsson has achieved racing immortality.
Is May.
Dan Dakich's annual Tom Dakich Memorial Golf Outing presented by Franciscan Health is on the schedule and set for July 18th. Go to 1075thefan.com/events for details and tickets.
It's Kevin and Querry.
Kenny Moore has been great, but does his value go down in the new Gus Bradley scheme? It is a misconception to label Kenny Moore as just a slot cornerback. He is a very unique corner in that he can play both inside and outside for you. I don't look at it like he deserves a massive pay increase, but the guy should be making more money than the 27th best corner in the NFL.
Kevin and Querry.
Weekday mornings at 7
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. It's the Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
That it is, and the coach is out living his best life, hanging with the fam this afternoon, so we are happy to keep the train moving here. Charlie Clifford of Wish TV, Channel 8 in town, alongside Eddie Garrison, who's somehow kept this train on the track for nearly 2.5 hours. It is 2:30 on the circle, beautiful day, and we're still toasting the man who wears 8 for Chip Ganassi Racing. When that red flag came out, put yourself in Marcus Ericsson's shoes. Guy from Sweden had to cut his own checks to get through the karting circuit. His family, you know, putting everything on the line so Marcus could chase his dream. Kenny Breck, the former winner in 99, saying, hey, that kid, there's something there. We need to invest in him. We need to make sure he has a team so he has a chance to become a professional. And He realizes a Formula One dream early, gets to the top of the top, and despite having his best season, he was cut loose after his last Formula One season, comes to the States, and now is an Indianapolis 500 champion. 31 years old. We know it's been a week, to say the least. I don't know how much he's slept, and as we hop on the phone with him here in a moment, we're just going to find out, what's it like being an Indianapolis 500 champion? What is it like doing this whirlwind media tour for the first time? And ultimately, what's changed the past few days? So without further ado, Marcus Ericsson joins us now on the Dan Dakich Show. Charlie Clifford is in. Marcus, my first question for you is, where have you eaten breakfast the last 5 days? If you can walk me through, if you can remember how you've started your day each day since winning the 500.
That would be a bit of a challenge. It's been like literally flat out since Sunday afternoon when I took the checkered flag. It's been crazy, you know. I had a full day of media after the checkered flag, and then Monday woke up in Indianapolis, had full day of media there, and then the victory celebration banquet in the evening, and then jumped on a jet to New York Monday night. Full day of media in New York on Tuesday, opening bell there on NASDAQ and throwing first pitch at the Yankees game, and then back to Indianapolis for some simulator, and then today in Detroit preparing for the weekend. So it's been crazy for sure.
My word, did you get the quintessential New York skyline, glass of champagne, soak it all in moment? What was the coolest part about being in the Big Apple and being on the top of the motorsports world, Marcus?
I don't know. It's hard to pick one. Like, we had such an amazing day, and I really have to thank IndyCar for organizing that in New York. You know, like I said, I was there on NASDAQ in the morning, which was amazing. And then we had some interviews, and then we went to the Empire State Building and went up to the top there. They had like a secret floor that you can't get up to unless you sort of, they bring you there. So I guess I'm not supposed to say that, but I say it anyway because it was so cool. And then, throwing the first pitch on the Yankees game, I think that's definitely high up there on the list as well of things I've done in my life. So it was an amazing day for sure.
What was the warm-up like for the pitch? You're at the pinnacle of the baseball world. I don't know if you even picked up a bat as a kid in Sweden. Bring me into walking out of the dugout in the Bronx and knowing that there are 30,000 New Yorkers who will boo you if you throw this ball in the dirt and don't get it to home plate.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, growing up in Sweden and Europe, we don't have baseball really in Sweden, so I don't really know anything about it, but I still know about the Yankees, obviously, because it's such a big, you know, franchise all over the world. So I think that was probably, you know, it was in some ways a good thing because I didn't really feel any pressure. But the thing was, I'd never thrown a baseball all my life, pretty much. It was a bit scary, like going out there in front of all the people and like, I'm just going to try and throw this. And then everyone was telling me, like, you can't throw too short and blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, let's see how this goes. But it went all right. I think I still have to work on my throw, that's for sure. But it went okay.
Well, I'm glad they didn't get you to the mound and then stay, hey, everybody hold everything. We're going to make them wait 10 minutes. We're going to put them on the Jumbotron, zoom in, make them as nervous as possible, and try to recreate the nerves that maybe were flowing through the eight machine as you waited on pit lane to try to climb the mountain, man. Look, we're falling in love with this story because from everything I've read, your family at some point had to make a decision. Hey, this son of ours has some talent, but we're going to have to put a lot of our own entire life savings and work on the line in order for him to chase his dream. Was there a moment, dinner table conversation, chat outside with your old man, where you remembered that this was becoming very, very serious and you kind of took into account what your folks were willing to do to let you ultimately chase this dream?
Yeah, for sure. You know, I'm you know, so extremely thankful that my parents, you know, supported me from the start. And you know, I come from a normal family in Sweden. My dad is a house painter and my mom is an accountant. So, you know, we don't come from a rich background. And my dad had to, you know, sacrifice a lot to help me start with go-karts. I remember traveling around Sweden and have my go-kart, you know, load up in the back of my dad's van where I usually have all these painting stuff. And we would, like, take that out and put the go-kart back in the weekend and go racing. So I'm very thankful for that. And obviously to have them there for the race on Sunday and share this moment with my family was just incredibly special and very emotional for me.
Would the cart occasionally pick up a couple extra colors on it due to some cans that were half open that may have spilled over on the ride to the track? How did that work in karting growing up? That's a crazy story, yeah. Man. That's unbelievable.
Yeah. No, it's cool, you know. And then, like I said, my dad was, you know, working flat out all week, and then every extra penny he could get out over from his work, he would put on the go kart to you know help me go racing. So it was like I said, I'm so thankful for that, because without that I would definitely not be where I am today.
If I was a classmate of Marcus Ericsson early on in school, growing up as a kid, what was it like sitting next to Marcus Ericsson in class, being at recess with him? How would you describe yourself as a kid, Marcus?
You know, not a clown, but for sure, like, you know, a social guy that likes to be in the center of attention. But being Swede, you know, we are pretty conservative in general.
Right.
You know, here in America, that's probably being shy in a corner somehow. So, but yeah, I've always been, you know, a social guy and like to you know, talk to people and interact with people. And I think that was, I was as a kid as well.
Pronounce your hometown for me in Sweden, because I'm going to butcher it.
Kumla.
If I'm riding a bike in Kumla around as, you know, a teenager in the neighborhood, what does that look like? What did home look like for you growing up?
It's a pretty small town on the countryside. It's a bit of a suburb to a bigger city called Örebro. And Kumla is just 20,000 people living there. And
wow.
We're mostly famous, actually, for having the biggest prison in Sweden.
So, like, oh,
the highest
wonderful.
Security prison. So, yeah, I lived, like, a mile from that growing up. So I like to say it was, like, the safest place on earth, because if one of these bad guys ever got out, they would, you know, get the hell out of there as soon as possible. So.
Right. They weren't looking to stay the night.
No, exactly.
That's wild. And no speeding tickets that ever made you venture towards those grounds? You were never any trouble growing up?
I've stayed out of that place, thankfully. So all that's
right.
All good.
All right. We won't do the fact checking there. We'll take you at your word. Hey, give me, like, if it weren't for that break, or if it weren't for, maybe it's Kenny Breck, maybe that name rhymes. Looking back, what were some breaks that came Marcus Ericsson's way that ultimately led to you having a chance to win the biggest race in the world?
Yeah, I mean, it's been a journey for sure, you know, starting all the way from, you know, we talked about my dad, you know, giving me the chance there with the go-karts. And then when I was 15, I won the Swedish and the Nordic Championship in go-karts. And that's when Kenny Brack and another guy called A.L., and also a racing driver, they sort of saw that and picked me up to their program to help a Swedish talent and gave me the opportunity to start driving race cars. And, you know, it's been step by step from then on. I did my 5 years of F1, but it was tough in F1 because in Formula One, it's a lot about to be in the right car and team. So
sure.
It was frustrating years there in Formula One, and I was sort of struggling to show my talent, I felt like. So after that fifth year, I was really keen to try something else, and I really wanted to go to IndyCar because I think it's the, you know, the coolest championship in the world, and especially now I think it's the best championship in the world if you look at the drivers that's in it. So yeah, I think all that hard work and you know, now I'm in my fourth year here in the States, and I've really taken steps each year, and I felt like last year was a real breakthrough year, winning two races and you know, running up front in the championship, and all that was building up to what happened last Sunday.
You have to forgive me. I'm forgetting her name, but I was right next to your better half when that yellow flag went up. All the crew members were standing on the ledge looking at each other. What's happened? What's the word? And we all just blurted out, it's over. He won. And so I would like to take a little credit for breaking the news to your pit team that it was complete. Marcus Ericsson did get it done. Tell me for your, is it still girlfriend, correct, who clearly was had more fun than anyone? How has she handled all of the attention here? I mean, let's face it, you guys are now you're in the spotlight, Marcus, and I think your lives in the United States have now changed forever.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I was very, very, you know, extremely happy to have Iris, my girlfriend, there this weekend, and she's been such an incredible support for me this year. You know, we've just been together since January, so it's still pretty new, but she's been amazing, and to share this victory with her as well as my family was just, it was incredible, and then it makes it even more special. And it's been fun because she was actually supposed to fly home on Monday after the race to go back to Denmark where she's from.
No way.
And do her exams, because she have her exams today, actually. But then after the win, I told her, like, we need to change this. And she reorganized everything now, so she will do it in August instead. And she went with me to New York, and she's with me now in Detroit. So, yeah, she's the best, and I'm so lucky to have her.
That was a brilliant decision. That would have been the most depressing plane ride home. I got to fly home and take a freaking exam? No way. There's no way. What class was it?
He said, you know, it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing, you know. I mean, hopefully I will win many more 500s, but, you know, the first one and everything we've done this week, it's been so much fun, and to share that with her, it's been super special.
What class was it, Marcus? What's she studying for? We're going to send her some good luck.
Yeah, she's doing a business degree, so it's pretty hard work, you know, like it's serious stuff. So, I'm very, very lucky that she's still here with me, and then I'm going to support her everything I can so she can pass it in August instead.
Iris, take it from all of us that struggled with school in the States. There is always summer school. You can always do it over. Hey.
Exactly.
Marcus Ericsson, from your father, who you shared, and your mother, who made this sacrifice so many years ago. It is one of the great things that makes Indianapolis such a special place. You deserve it. You did it. And now go win that championship, all right?
Sounds like a plan. Can't wait.
Thank you very much. That is Marcus Ericsson, the champion of the 106th Indianapolis 500-mile race. He had to earn it down to the last minute, folks. That red flag came out, and I know so many of you in the grandstands were thinking, oh gosh, this young driver had it, and now who knows who's going to take this thing. And he didn't blink. As he shared with AC on Sports Locker Sunday, on Wish TV on Sunday, he got some fantastic advice from Dario Franchitti the night before the race. Hey, if I'm in a situation where it's a 2-lap, 3-lap thing and I'm leading, how do I handle this? And the 8 machine was the quickest off the line. Pato O'Ward charged on that second lap down the front stretch. And some people may say, hey, the weaving defensive tactic, do we need to look at that? Well, look, anyone in the field would have done that. And B, O'Ward even admitted after the race, the straight line speed simply wasn't there for the Chevys to catch really a handful of the Ganassi machines, and it happened to be Marcus Ericsson at the end. So I hope you enjoyed that and got a better glimpse into just how big of a long shot story this is. I know he wears the Honda logo and he's with arguably the best team, and clearly the talent's there, but this all started a long, long time ago, and someone who is going to be a worthy champion and soak up all the tradition of being a winner in Indianapolis. You do not have to worry about Marcus Ericsson understanding what he just accomplished. So Charlie Clifford with you today for the coach. We are going to wrap up the show with Eddie Garrison, a quick break, and we will set you up for your Thursday evening, which you should be outside and enjoying it. We'll be back.
Right now, it's a seller's market. I'm Patrick Keller with Crest Point Real Estate. Get your free home value estimate from me in 60 seconds at sellwithpatrick.com.
At Diamonds Direct right now, there's nothing standing in your way of owning the piece of jewelry you've been dreaming of. No down payment and no finance charges for 5 whole years on any purchase. Take the amazing Diamonds Direct price you're used to, divide by 60, and that's your payment. It's a smart way to buy. Keep your money in your pocket and still add that amazing ring, band, or bracelet to your collection. Even the upgrade you've been wanting. 5 years, zero interest on any purchase. Only at Diamonds Direct. Get all the details at DiamondsDirect.com. Unapproved credit.
Start a new career with a job that keeps your community safe. The Marion County Sheriff, Kerry Forrestal, is hiring detention deputies to work in the brand new Community Justice Center. You'll supervise and guard offenders, making Marion County a better place to live. Starting pay begins at around $40,000 a year with a $5,000 signing bonus. Enjoy great benefits like complete health coverage and pension plan. Start your career as a detention deputy and earn the respect of your community. Apply today at joinmcso.indy.gov.
Hey, it's JMV for BullseyeEventGroup.com and the best pregame party anywhere. The Colts are going to Vegas this year, and so can you. The official Colts Las Vegas fan travel package is a private air charter with hundreds of Colts fans. That means no stops, no layovers, a direct flight. Leave Indy Saturday morning, return Monday afternoon. Two-night weekend travel package at Caesars Palace. Tickets to the Colts and the Raiders game included. The official Colts Las Vegas fan travel package includes admission into the official Colts tailgate in Vegas, Vegas style. Book your spot now. BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Every Monday through Thursday here on the Dan Dakich Show, we have a race of the day brought to you by Horseshoe Indianapolis Racing and Casino. To enter, go to 107.5 The Fan Twitter account or at Dan Dakich and retweet the tweet that goes around right around 2 o'clock for your chance to win a VIP pack with $50 for betting and $50 for dining to Horseshoe Indianapolis Racing and Casino. Horseshoe, that is. All right, here are your entrants for today. Number one, Justice in Vegas. That goes to Sue Johnson. The two, Scratched. Three, Concrete Charlie. Chris Baxter, he's yours. Four, Baby Vincent. That goes to Troy Vector. Successful Don. Jake G, you're riding with Successfully Don. Done, excuse me. Hickory High, Gary Foster. High Cotton Justice, Tony Volanovich. And finally, the eight, Guard Duty, to Scott Hall. Good luck, everybody.
The following is presented by the Indiana Thoroughbred Breed Development Program. From Horseshoe Indianapolis Racing and Casino, it's time for the Thoroughbred Horse Race of the Day on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Horseshoe Indianapolis, a heart-pounding destination.
Wham. Running at Horseshoe Indianapolis, High Cotton Justice broke sharp. Good speed from Successfully Done, and there's Baby Vincent in the yellow silks. Now who's dashed to the front here for Rodney Prescott? It's a short lead for Baby Vincent as Jose Riquelme has High Cotton Justice right there too near the speed after the first furlong and a half, with Guard Duty vying for third with a Successfully Done. Justice in Vegas is running in fifth. Hickory High is sixth past the half-mile pole, and Concrete Charlie trails the state-bred sprint here in the Wednesday opener. The quarter, 22.68 seconds, three furlongs to go. It's Baby Vincent paving the path around the far turn, leads three quarters of length as Guard Duty now strides up for Eddie Perez. High Cotton Justice third, but under pressure in the orange cap. On the far outside, Concrete Charlie now mustering a rally. Successfully Done, Justice in Vegas and Hickory High as Baby Vincent spins them in. Half mile, 46.17 seconds. One furlong to go for Baby Vincent, who clings on as Guard Duty now comes to take on Baby Vincent, and these two will settle it past the 16th. Concrete Charlie third and running on with Eddie Perez. It's Guard Duty who gains the advantage. Guard Duty wins three quarters of length to Baby Vincent. Concrete Charlie third and High Cotton Justice finish fourth.
Just minutes from Indy, off I-74 in Shelbyville. Horseshoe Indianapolis has live thoroughbred and quarter horse racing through November 23rd, thanks in part to the Indiana Thoroughbred Breed Development Program. And keep listening for your chance to win with Horseshoe Indianapolis's Thoroughbred Race of the Day on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Invisible Fence Brand has been protecting pets from their environment for nearly 50 years. Learn more how Invisible Fence Brand can surround your pets with care. Go to InvisibleFence.com today.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan. The Dan Dakich Show, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Let's roll. Congrats to Scott Hall, winner of today's race of the day, brought to you by Horseshoe Indianapolis Racing and Casino. Be sure to tune in Monday through Thursday for your chance at a VIP prize pack for 50 in betting, 50 in dining at Horseshoe Indianapolis Racing and Casino. So there's your result, 8 4-3, guard duty. He paid out $840 to win Baby Vincent, $420 to place, and Concrete Charlie, $480 to show. $2 exacta payout, $26.20, 50-cent trifecta payout. You're walking home with $43.65. That was your race of the day. Congrats to Scott Hall. And we're going to keep it here with breaking NFL news. A salute to one of the toughest dudes to ever line up in a backfield. Frank Gore has called it a career. 5 Pro Bowls. He's third on the NFL's all-time leading rush list. 16 seasons. Frank Gore retiring from the National Football League after signing a one-day contract with the San Francisco 49ers. You remember him best from his 3 seasons in Indianapolis, 2015 to 2017, but 10 years as a Niner to start his career. This is a cool way to go out, according to his agent, Drew Rosenhaus. And Frank Gore will be heading to Canton, Ohio. Again, third on the all-time leading rush list. And some folks will kind of look at that with a bit of, I don't know what to put it as, but you cannot knock Frank Gore for continuing to play football and line up every Sunday without incident. He is 39 years old. How many running backs are 39 years old? How many players at any position outside of punter or quarterback are 39? And Frank Gore was nothing but a great guy here in Indianapolis. And unfortunately, you know, his last season here was a downer year. That would have been Chuck Pagano's final season here. Man, we were all kind of curious, how much longer does Frank have in the tank? Well, now you get your answer. And he didn't play this past season. You remember, all right, where was he last year? He was a Jet in 2020, and that was it. And now we get word that he's getting his round of applause, as he should. Third all-time leading rusher, Frank Gore, calling it a career. Also, Ryan Fitzpatrick, Eddie, hanging it up today. Journeyman quarterback. Feel like he played for every team in the AFC East at one point, in addition to Washington, and one of the best beards in NFL history. Will now get a little time in the spotlight as well.
Yeah, I'm seeing that he may have a role into the new Amazon Prime Thursday Night Football.
I don't know.
Yeah, that's what I think it was either Schefter or Rappaport was saying. So it's not like he's completely done. He's still going to be around, so we'll see that beard forever.
I believe that's Al Michaels and Kirk Herbstreit now on Thursday night, so maybe they make way for a little rotating three-man booth, or that's
maybe they just try to just do a three-man booth in general.
Fitzpatrick's hysterical, so I would be on. That'd be a yes vote from me over here. Good update there. Interesting. Hey, it's been a pleasure today. We are thrilled to hand you off into the first real weekend of your 2022 summer. As we said at the very beginning, just go treat yourself this weekend. This is it before everything gets nuts. And now that you've come down from what was an epic week out on the West Side, thank you to Marcus Ericsson for hopping in. I think you can all appreciate where he's come from to reach this point in the racing world, not only to be in the IndyCar field, but to be an Indianapolis 500 winner now. Glad his first pitch, Eddie, didn't go terribly awry at Yankee Stadium.
Made it to the plate. I did see the video.
Good, because I missed it, and I was I should have done the homework there before. That's good. That's good. KB, as always, you'll see him in the morning. Interesting thoughts there on the wide receiver room. We'll see if things get shaken up again before training camp with an addition of a veteran wideout. Mark Carmen out of Chi-Town. We relived the Pacer Bulls glory days while also taking a look at Matt Eberflus's first stint in Chicago. And it sounds like Flus has started quickly, which is good. For a great guy who we got to know behind the scenes here in Indy as the defensive coordinator. And Jason Dumas, who started the show, Warriors, Celts, Game 1. Who you got? Eddie, let's put a little skin in the game for the series. Where are you going with this NBA Finals series that people seem to be leaning Warriors, but it's not going to be a runaway series, according to most.
I think it'll be Warriors in seven. I think tonight, as we talked about earlier, as I noted earlier, the team that is favored by less than six is 62-0-1 against the spread. And I'm going to ride with the Warriors tonight, whatever the spread is, as long as it's not more than six. But I do think the first quarter money line for the Boston Celtics is a little interesting because it has been a week since the Warriors have played, so they could come out a little rusty.
You're doing some digging here. I like that theory. In theory, the Chase Center fans may say, hey, we haven't lost a game at home all postseason. Don't get too excited about that. But that's a good point. We'll see if Boston can take the emotion of game seven in Miami and let that carry over and steal one to start this series out west. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you get some sleep too, because that's a late tip at 9 o'clock tonight. But appreciate JD's insight. He does a great job covering the Warriors. Our quick hitters, again, the news updates to get you out here in our final minute. Alexander Rossi to Aero Schmidt, McLaren Aero SP, leaving Andretti, starting next year. Frank Gore retiring. Ryan Fitzpatrick retiring. What have I missed, Eddie?
I don't think you missed anything.
Yeah, it wasn't a earth-shattering day by breaking news here, but nonetheless, Charlie Clifford of Wish TV, thank you to the team here for filling in. Always an honor to step in for Coach Eddie Garrison. Thanks for leading the way. And JMV's up next. Have a great Thursday afternoon, everybody.
Everybody needs a man cave.
Ours just happens to be a little bigger than most.
All right, let's not go there. Let's just invite them to our place.
We're getting together for a night in the fan cave, brought to you by Forum Credit Union on June 23rd. We'll chat about sports, tell lies, and talk smack.
We'll start the evening down in the Larceny Lounge with munchies, beer, and plenty of Larceny and Evan Williams bourbon.
This is going to be a heck of a party and a show rolled into one.
Tickets are on sale now at 1075thefan.com.
Hi guys, it's Andrew with Pine Grove Medical Clinic. Is erectile dysfunction damaging your relationship? Are you sick of the pill and all the side effects? Well, welcome to the future. We have a major medical breakthrough. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most advanced form of wave therapy. Backed by 60 clinical studies, our technology uses pressure waves to repair and open up blood vessels. We've helped countless men get rid of their ED. But what is the true end result? Their relationship, even their lives, improve drastically. If you're ready to regain your love life, call us right now, and not only will the assessment and ultrasound be free, we'll also give you a gift that produces immediate results in the bedroom. It almost never fails. This is worth $550, and it's free to callers right now. 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and experience what I call the happiness ripple effect. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now. 317-552-1111.
Hey, tennis fans. With the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app, you can smash, slice, and spin your way to big tennis paydays. That's because we're serving up the excitement of live in-game betting, where you can bet on all the action, including point-by-point betting from tournaments around the world. Plus, with BetRivers' award-winning customer service, it's game, set, and match. Download the BetRivers.com Sportsbook app. It's a whole new game.
Must be 21. Must be located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
911, what's your emergency?
Por favor, necesito ayuda. Está volando y creo que me va a pegar otra vez.
I will get some.